Oof. That wind is pretty crazy.
Good evening and welcome to the February 24th meeting of the Hampton Board of Selectmen. Please stand for the salute to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd like to introduce the board. To my far left, Selectman Mike Pierce. To my immediate left, Selectman Phil Bean. To my far right, Selectman Mike Plough. To his left, Selectman Mary Louise Woolsey. To my immediate right, Town Manager Fred Welch. And I'm Chairman Dick Nichols. The first item on the agenda tonight is a public hearing relative to the parking status on the west side of Ocean Boulevard from High Street to Church Street. I thought, as far as the format for going through this, that we'd start off with Fred just giving a little bit of a quick overview of what precipitated this whole thing, then go to Jamie as far as what the PD's recommendations are, bring it to the board for questions and comments for Jamie, go out to the public and for comment, and then bring it back to the board. So if we can start with you,
Fred. Start a circle.
Right. And Jamie, if you and is Rich here, or is it?
Not yet.
Okay. You want to maybe come up to the table or get comfortable?
Well, just to let everybody into what's going on here. The question was asked regarding the 10-minute parking signs on the west side of Ocean Boulevard. They've been there since, I don't know, probably since bicycles were transferred into automobiles. The question was, are they legal? Are they supposed to be there? Who put them there? So what I did was I went to the state of New Hampshire, and I talked to the Traffic Bureau and the Department of Transportation. They have a record of all of the parking restrictions on state highways statewide. The gentleman, who I know from another town who works at DOT, researched their records and found that, in fact, those signs are not permitted. There is no ordinance. There is no state ordinance regarding them. So we talked for a while, and I asked him what it would take to make them legal. And he said, well, it's pretty simple. He says, you need to get your selectmen to enact an ordinance, a parking ordinance, which will then be sent to state DOT Traffic Bureau. DOT Traffic Bureau will review it if they think it's appropriate. And obviously, these signs have been there since, I don't know how long, but longer than that. They'll approve it. It'll be signed by the Commissioner of Transportation, be recorded in the Office of the Secretary of State. It'll also be recorded in the town clerk's office in Hampton. That will make the signs legal and the parking restrictions or allowances legal as well. So this is part of that process, is to get public input. You want to keep them, tell us so that we know what's going on, and we can then transmit that information to the state of New Hampshire along with the selectmen enacting an ordinance to make sure the signs are proper and they can be enforced by the police department, which they cannot now be enforced by the police department. So, with that.
Okay. Chief Sullivan provided us a report in the middle of January detailing the police department's recommendations. Jamie, do you want to cover that?
Sure. I'll just go over again. Based on, Fred had given me a list of measured streets from High Street all the way down to Church Street, basically. Had somebody go out and measure those areas specifically where these zones are. Asked us to go out, look at them, and give our opinion. We did that. Now, again, just a bit of history. Let's keep in mind, this is a state road. It's not a town road. We have enforced those signs over the years. I don't recall it ever being a huge problem where people called to complain. Frankly, on either end, we don't get too many calls about the violations on those 10-minute zones all that often anyway. And in my experience with some of these signs, and they've been down the main beach, on the state's position, when we would contact DOT or Division 6 to say, hey, somebody had a problem, and we've had several of them. Someone has a concern in this area, would like to make it a no parking zone. The response from them has always been, we will put up the signs as long as you enforce them, because they don't have a mechanism to enforce them. And that's generally the agreement has been. I think Fred's right that we've never really seen anything in writing. Generally, there's something the town sends off to them in writing requesting, hey, we want this to be a restricted zone, and then they'll post the signs. We do the enforcement when we see them. So back to, we went through this, a couple of our guys have gone out there and went on each of these locations. And in the maps, you see some yellow color-coded we gave you. Basically, it's some of the areas where we feel, we see there's three options for you. One, we do nothing and keep it the way it's always been. Number two, from our point of view, the difference between 10-minute zones and no parking zones. Obviously, from an enforcement point of view, a no parking zone is an easier thing to deal with. We are mindful of those hotels, motels, and businesses that do have to have quick drop-off stuff, so we understand that. But a lot of these areas, they don't. If we're going to restrict parking there, a 10-minute zone, the problem for us is someone calls and says, that's a violation. Our guys have to go, mark the tire, wait 10 minutes to be sure, and we've had some issues of folks like, no, you want to mark now, give them a ticket now, that kind of thing. Someone comes and moves it, and there's a problem. So from our point of view in enforcement, if we're going to have a restricted zone, no parking is the easiest way to deal with it. Someone calls and has a violation or a problem there, we deal with it. So our biggest concerns are, you'll see the yellow markings along there, it's those 20-foot from the intersections, which you're not allowed to park by state law in any event, block sight distances, people pull out of the side streets. The others, there's some areas where you just cannot park. You're in the roadway when you pull off to the side of the road. And those are some of the things that we've indicated in the yellow, and I've did in the memo that I sent to Fred onto the board on January 15th. We give each of those locations what we would suggest that if we're going to do that, these are the areas that we would make sure that there are no parking in there because it's just unsafe. And that's basically it in a nutshell.
Okay, questions from the board or comments? Or
I think it's a great job. Very well done.
I do have one question for you now. What if we were to allow a car to stop in front of a motel to unload? And then when they're done unloading, they can park it in the hotel's parking lot or wherever that may be.
I think, Mike, that was probably the impetus of the 10 minutes in the first place. People dropping off into cottages and what have you. It's a quick turnover. We can enforce that. That's more of a challenge to us. The 10-minute zones are more of a challenge to us. But if that's what's necessary, we can still deal with that.
If we had no parking signs up, though, technically you wouldn't be able to stop and unload your car, technically. Right?
That's correct, yeah.
What if we had, haven't I seen before some places where they say loading and unloading only or something?
Loading
like
zones?
Yeah.
Well, I guess the question here is, what are we trying to do and why are we trying to do it? Something's been that way for a very long time, right? Now, some of these signs have disappeared. You know, because there are some residences that are up there, and our experience are folks want to park there. They want to have their friends and family park in there. From our point of view, again, it's a state area for the most part. Unless we're getting complaints about it, as long as it's not blocking a roadway or an unsafe issue, we really haven't dealt with it. We haven't gone in to deal with that. And it really hasn't been a huge problem. There are some. Our concern, again, is anything related to the intersections is our first priority. It's a concern to people pulling out of those side streets. You don't see it's a danger. Not a lot of room for folks in a busy time up there to take evasive action if someone pops out too far, that type of thing. So those, to me, are just no-brainers. 20 feet from the intersections, you can't be parking there. Other than that, frankly, I listen to the public and make a decision from there.
Couple of questions. How would you delineate the 20 feet from the intersection, on the pavement or via sign?
I would prefer by something on the pavement, absolutely.
Right.
Because then it's consistent. Everybody sees that's the area, and they don't park there.
Right.
Okay. You're not going to get out with a measuring stick and know where 20 feet is.
Okay. And then I kind of listened to what you were saying, and I had read this beforehand or whatever, and the way I'm looking at it, there's generally speaking almost two choices. Either one choice is pretty much leave it the way it is with the exception of the 20 feet from the intersections and so on and so forth. The other choice is to take all those locations, perhaps with the exception of where there are retail or motel or whatever, and turn the 10-minute parking into no parking.
I think that's probably accurate. Yeah.
Two choices. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions or?
No.
Okay. Public. Somebody from the public wish to ask questions or comments? Skip.
First, I want to emphasize how important I think this topic is tonight. If any of you who know me know how much I love to ski, I had a rented condo that I'm supposed to be up there now skiing, but I stayed home and gave it up to come to this meeting for this, so it's very important. I'd like to take you back, if I could, to the year of 1978 to 1982. There's a group in Hampton that was called the Hampton Beach Improvement Committee, similar to what they have today for the commission. But anyways, this group was made up of the beach people, which was like Beverly Hollingsworth, John Grand Mason, myself, Fred Shockey, Norm Beaulieu, Bob Preston. Along with that, we had members from the chamber, members from DRED, and some of the town people as well. And we got together and we tried to decide how can we increase business in this town and to increase tourism, because we knew we had a lack of rooms and things like that. So that was the objective. The challenge was to envision the future, and we knew that it was linked to the perception that fundamental changes had to be made in both the zoning and planning before this could occur, and then it was going to take a lot of patience to realize any of the implications of these changes. So these fundamental changes were put through, and they were made back then through the planning board, through the zoning. We went through that anyone who was going to build more places for tourists to come, you could build right on your lot line. No setback, as long as you had a one-hour firewall. Parking requirement, no parking on site necessary. As long as you were within 350 feet, you could go ahead and build what you did and wanted to build. So we did this, and with that, the state and the town both gave us guarantees. I don't say guarantees, but they led us to believe, don't worry about the parking. We're going to allow seasonal parking in our lots. So the state was going to allow leased parking in the front at a reasonable amount for these hotels to do business. In front of me, it was $100. Down at it was about the same, I think, down at the Ashworth lot at the time. Now we're seeing that's already gone. We actually did this building, and we got the people to come. It increased the revenue in this area. It increased everything in this area, and I'm going to get into the figures a little bit later. But now that all these businesses that were conforming at the time, doing their best to increase business and tourism in this whole area for the town of Hampton, are now being penalized, and we're looked at as second-class citizens down there. Right now, we're being challenged with a trash thing. When we did the setbacks, with zero setbacks and everything, we didn't have to think about where to put dumpsters or a lot of barrels, because the town said, don't worry about it. We're going to pick your trash up 7 days a week on the front for your commercials and businesses so we can get more business, and on the side streets, we'll pick it up 3 times. Well, now we're seeing that we're challenged for that. We're also challenged now that the parking thing's gone away. The state decided, well, I think we need $1,000 for your space out there, not 100. And I think the town's Ashworth lot, you've gone up to $900. Basically, it makes it very difficult for anybody who has a small inn or a small guest house to make money if they have to pay that amount of parking. I want to go through now and just let you know the implications on my own business. On a Saturday, I will have 80 to 100 people checking in, coming in, paying, you know, getting directions to where they're going to go, and any other questions that they might have. Without that parking in front for them to do it, I'm out of business. And it's necessary. Then for the inn, which is similar to many of the inns up the street, they come in, they said, this looks like a nice place. Let's stop and find out if they have any vacancies and how much it is, and they want to see a room. It takes a good 10 minutes for them to negotiate these things before we can tell them where we have off-street parking. So without that ability, it puts me out of business. And I look up the street, and there's many, many others in the same situation, whether it's the Atlantic Motel, whether it's Jonathan's Motel, it's the Sea Spiral Suites, and just you keep going, you know, the Atlantic Breeze Suites. All of these need that temporary parking to come in. When we got all these people to come after building all these units, the increased amount of money, here's some of the figures, and I'm sure you've been hearing this and you know it, but you've got $1.7 million in parking revenues now that's brought into the state. Here, for rooms and meals and tax from this area, it's $7 million that we brought this up to. $830,000 of BET and business profits tax. And then if you look at the whole community, they say that it's about a $1 billion direct and indirect tourist dollars that are coming in from what we do down there. So this 10-minute parking is crucial to all of this type of development. I just can't even foresee thinking about getting by. We have a new guy up the street, Tom Higgins, just moved in. What a way to greet him. Tom comes in, and he's probably got 3 times what I do checking in on Saturday. He's a lot bigger agency. And he's got 300 people that have to come in and look for places. It's a lot. So I'd like everybody to think about keeping the vision that we started back in that early years in the 70s of the future and how to build it and help support us. And please, don't change what's there. And actually, I'd like to just mention a couple other things, too, to what you had gone out and measured, you said, different areas of
for that. I think Public Works did for Fred.
Okay. Well, let me just give you a little background. They paved this over as about 10 years ago, and they did a quick topping out there. Mm-hmm. And they line those lines. At the time, they didn't leave us enough space to pull in to have a really good parking spot off, you know, by the sidewalk. I called up the gentleman's name at DOT at that time was Garrett Garstang. Within less than a year, Garrett came down and repainted all the lines. So he took the line where all the people had to have the 10-minute parking, and then he divided the rest up in two. Several years ago, they repaved again a little bit, and they repainted the lines. This time I called, Garrett's moved on. There's a new, the new gentleman there is named Hovey, I believe, is his name at DOT. And he said, oh, I have to give you 11, I have to give 11 feet for each lane, so I started at the fence and moved over, and you got what was left. Well, it is now, we are negotiating actually with a couple people in the state to see if they can't convince them to go back and do it the way they've always done it, giving us a decent, you know, a safe place for people to pull over. Right now, where it's so tight, they either have to get up on the sidewalk or be very, very careful moving in and out of their car. But I hope that you won't change and take away that. And one other thing, now you're talking about maybe even doing it from an intersection. Of course, mine, I'm on the corner of Church Street. If you take 20 feet, I'm dead. And if you take 20 feet from the next intersection, which is Fuller Acres, you've got nothing in there. And then from Fuller Acres, your next street is Tilton. If you take 20 feet both sides of Tilton, Atlantic has no place to put it. So there's little lanes coming in. So if you're going to go back on intersections, once again, it's wiping out, in essence, any of our parking.
Okay, can I comment and at the same time a question? Because I'm sitting here looking at the last page, which essentially contains from Church Street going south, maybe about as far as Ron's Landing. It appears to me that we've got within the 20 feet of the intersection at the intersection of Church Street and Ocean Boulevard, but do not appear to be lopping off 20 feet either side of the Fuller Acres. So we're not, if you look at this, you're not necessarily taking the 20 feet on every single.
The 20 feet is a state RSA dealing with an intersection. It's just a sight distance safety issue.
Yeah.
And Skip's right. I mean, much of Hampton Beach doesn't conform to anything.
Yep.
And which makes it unsafe. Yeah. That's it. Now, what we do with it is up to you folks. All I'm saying, you're asking for my recommendation. Yep. We need to keep things safe or don't do anything at all. It's a state road. It's not our problem. It's a state road.
Right. And Skip, currently are you, you know, based on customers coming and going, are they actually parking right up to the
crosswalk
street?
Yes. And, but you have to remember, too, this is a one-way street heading that direction, so you're not having any, and it's a one-way street down Church Street, so you're not getting anybody coming out of there, so there's no blocking of any site or anything like that. So to me, it's never been a problem. We've never had a problem in all these, I've been there 40 years, I've never had a problem. So I just...
Okay.
If it's not broke, don't fix it.
But just to your point about them repaving and bringing the line over closer.
Yes.
The reason wasn't because they had to have 11-foot lanes.
Right.
About 10 years ago, the State Department of Transportation made the judgment that if they move the lines over far enough and the catch basins are just inside the line, they then become town responsibility. No. They've tried to enforce that in this particular public works district for the state. So they're trying to squeeze over, yes, they're trying to give more travel room, but they're trying to pass everything from the fog line out to the town,
great,
including the drainage.
Hmm. Well, there's no drainage there to worry about. Okay. Just the one there from the state, yeah.
thank you very much, Skip. Bob?
Hi, thank you. Bob Preston, and I operate Preston Real Estate. I thought I'd come by and see who I should thank to try to put my friends Oceanside and Harris Real Estate out of business, because I've been trying to do it for a long time. You know, the traffic for us, I don't think is a bigger problem on Saturdays. You know, we have a lot of people coming and going. The people are checking out. They're dropping off keys. They're checking in. The traffic in a lot of these places is slowing down anyway. People are cognizant of what's happening, and it's an important part of what we all do all summer. It doesn't matter whether it's the real estate people or the coffee guy or the hotel. You know, it's important. People driving down that road, it's not just people checking in. Sometimes it's people that are coming to see if they might want to stay here. That's what we all did. You know, when you think about when you went away with your wife and your kids and you said, let's go see if this place works, do they have a pool? So to lose that lane, I think, hurts us all tremendously. And one point is, when you do talk to the state, I think if you started adding up what those people pay for the room and meals tax, it's an awful lot of money. I don't think the state is going to want to hurt this. So I'm sure that there's a way for us to all figure it out. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Someone else? Bill?
Worst nightmare, a former selectman coming in talking to you.
Yeah.
Telling you how great things were when they were on the board.
You only got five minutes.
That? So you don't have to answer. I know it's not politically correct to answer that.
I'm sorry, what was your name?
Bill Lally. I think the chief started his presentation by saying he had three options, and the first one was to do nothing. And I wholeheartedly vote for doing nothing.
Okay.
As long as I can remember in this town, and my family bought property here in the 60s in North Beach, those signs were always there. It was always 10-minute parking. And as Fred said, who knows who put them there? And I just talked to the chief briefly earlier that I probably remember one time in the 28 years I was on the police department that I got a call to go to North Beach in that area to get a complaint in a 10-minute parking zone. It's just not an issue. I mean, I think if we went back, if the chief had the logs in here for the past 10 summers, and we looked up how many complaints the Hampton Police Department got for 10-minute infractions in those zones, we'd be hard-pressed to come up with five or six in the past 10 years. I mean, I'm just throwing it out there, Chief. I'll be happy to go back and look in those logs if I had time, but it's just not an issue. It's a non-issue. The only thing it does that I see, and as Skip and Bob just mentioned, once you get south of Rocky Bend and you start hitting the motels there and people checking in and pulling up, it's not an issue of people parking there during the day. They don't do that.
Mm-hmm.
And you go down, I own the business at 369 Ocean Boulevard next to Skip's. And it's just people run in, they get something, they run out. They go into Skip's, they check in, they check out. Just mentioned Tom Higgins just moved up from P Street,
mm-hmm.
up just north of us, put his new business there. I mean, these are killers to small business. These small issues are killers to small businesses. And I know we have an issue. I won't bring up the trash, and that's another whole thing. But those things hurt the small businessman. I just hope that you'll look at this and kind of leave it the way it is. Police department, they've always enforced it. If they see someone there for a while or someone calls, they'll come up, you know, hey, move along. The major issue in North Beach you have is not Ocean Boulevard. It's 19th Street, 18th Street, 17th Street, people parking on both sides. The town recently, a couple of years ago, I know the chief and Rich Sawyer had worked a lot on this, was to paint the areas at the bottom of those streets so people wouldn't park at the very areas.
Yeah.
So an ambulance could not even turn up one of those side streets.
Yeah.
There's issues on the small narrow streets south of the police station on Ashworth. Those are parking issues that have to be addressed. But
right.
But this one, this 10-minute zone, I would just ask you to leave it the way it is, and I think that people can police themselves with that. Thank you.
Someone else.
Hi. I'm here for my parents. They actually live on 833 Ocean Boulevard, and my name is Mary Jo Gilloon-Hubel. They do have an issue with the parking, and I just wanted to bring up an issue of safety, because I've witnessed it myself. For the 10-minute parking, people don't abide by it. And there has been times that I have been up there having to walk out into the traffic because the car is parked along the street over encroaching onto that area where I have to walk out into traffic to go around. I feel that to be a real safety issue in that area of the residents. Just on this trip, I'm not talking about the businesses. I'm just talking about the residential area. You know, pulling out of someone's driveway, it's hard if you have a van or an SUV parked to see to come out into that, and you don't have that. You can't stop. You're not going to stop. You're not going to see. Especially in the summertime, the traffic is a lot more, so it makes it more risky to be able to, you know, to do that, because you've got more traffic coming in both directions. So I would like them, my parents have asked that 10-minute parking be enforced, because it is creating an issue for them and the safety of the public. So that's all I'm here for, just to let that be voiced. I don't want to see anybody get hurt, and I'm sure they don't either, and that's why they asked me to come.
Okay. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Someone else? Tom?
Yeah, my concern is the area south of Boar's Head, where I just relocated to. And prior to signing a lease and relocating there, I did meet with the police and asked if my business and the check-ins on Saturday were going to be a problem, and was told there was a 10-minute parking area in front. So it strikes me that from Church Street to Boar's Head certainly needs the 10-minute parking, whether North Beach wants it or not, I'm not sure. But it will affect me, and I never would have signed the lease if there was any possibility of losing the 10-minute.
Okay. Thank you. Someone else?
I'm Bill Dufresne. I own and live at 907 Ocean Boulevard on the corner of 19th Street and Ocean Boulevard. I think it would be wrong to categorically include both the main beach and the businesses and the residents in North Beach as the same thing. We have different issues and different concerns. I concur with Bill Lally in that the biggest problem in North Beach is the numbered streets and not Ocean Boulevard. Mm-hmm. There is the occasional car that spends more than 10 minutes there. I think the need to have a drop-off area. I, as a homeowner, have used that in delivering things to my home, large items and such. So it's an important thing. I think it's something that is very necessary for the businesses. But in terms of the residences on North Beach, it's an entirely different issue. When you pull out of a numbered street with a car parked in that area, mm-hmm. you have to let yourself be known. You put your nose out and let them see you because you can't see them. There is zero sight distance. Yeah. There's no safe sight distance. It doesn't happen a lot, but it does happen. And so I think it's important that we keep it as a 10-minute or less, or maybe more clearly demarcate them as an offload, temporary loading, 10-minute only. The intent of it be a little better known, because it can be a safety issue. It's physically impossible to park there, get out of your vehicle, and not enter on my property. If you're parked there, you're going to open your door, you're going to unload your lawn chairs, you're on my lawn. So there's also the ability for me to enjoy my property and not have people trespass, and it's a little bit of an issue too. But again, I've been there 9 years. There's been no real problem with that. The numbered streets are more the issue, and I think it's important to keep it for the businesses, but it's an entirely different issue on North Beach and needs to be a little more clearly demarcated and known what the intent of that area is.
Could you just clarify the differentiation between North Beach and down south of Boar's Head? You're suggesting that your opinion is we should keep the 10-minute parking.
Yeah, it hasn't been a problem historically.
Are you suggesting that we keep it as is in the North Beach area, call it 6th Street to 19th Street or whatever, or are you suggesting that we proceed with the 20-foot or whatever, no parking on the edge of the numbered streets or
I
whatever?
I think that to leave an area is necessary, but to be marked more properly. There are random signs. Some people don't think it exists in front of the house because there's not a sign in front of the house. Mm-hmm. Those who have the sign in front of the house think they have a privilege or a loser privilege because it's parking there. And what the intent of it is. I mean, it's easy to put a sign that says, short-term parking, unloading only, or something to that effect. I think that makes it a little more helpful. I mean, in my case, I literally go out in the street and I stop traffic to let people out of my driveway off of Ocean Boulevard without anybody parked there, because my house is 4 feet off the street, off the right-of-way line, and so is everyone's. So I'm a civil engineer. I spent 28 years doing exactly this, site and civil engineering. There is no safe site distance there right now. When you put a car there, it goes from maybe 20 or 30 feet to zero. And when I come out of the coffee shop and I'm going out onto Ocean Boulevard on a Saturday or Sunday morning, I don't see them. I let them see me. I put my nose out and say, can you see me? And I let them stop, because otherwise you're not getting out.
Yeah.
All right, you let cars park there for a long term, then it's trouble. But again, it hasn't been historically a problem for me in the 9 years I've been there. Another issue that does arise is I don't get my mail delivered. I had my neighbor did a rehab on the house for about 3 months, and they had contractors parking there for 3 months. I didn't get mail. I'd go a week without getting mail. I'm a self-employed civil engineer. I get mail, and I get checks at my house. Those are the ones I really want. The bills I wasn't too upset about. Not getting checks at home for a week was a little upsetting. So those are my concerns as a resident of North Beach, and I fully understand the businesses in the main beach. I mean, you have a different issue down there. They have traffic that might be moving 5 or 10 miles an hour. North Beach, it's a speedway up there on a summer night.
Can
And I listened to him coming. So it's an entirely different issue up there, and it should be treated, I think, a little differently, just in terms of what you mark the signs and how you mark the signs. But I'm not suggesting it completely be eliminated, because again, you know, I bought a nice 60-inch plasma for myself a few years ago, and that's how I got in my house. I backed in right there on that and loaded in. So, I mean, it does serve a purpose for us who live there. It just, again, I don't want to see somebody parked there all day long.
Yeah.
They're going to be literally camping out on my front lawn, and I'm going to be unable to get in and out of 19th Street.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Someone else? Maureen?
Hi, Maureen Buckley. I've heard two things tonight. First of all, the significant impact that touching this will do to so many important realties and businesses on this beach. And secondly, I heard more than once, in all the years that certain people have been here, they've never had a problem. Please leave it alone. Thank you.
Someone else?
Sure, Gil Mason. My parents are also owned property on Ocean Beach, on Ocean Boulevard, and I would say the same thing. I would not do anything about the areas where the businesses are. I think the businesses deserve their parking. Causing any effects to the businesses nowadays will be a problem. Differently, like I think Bill had said, North Beach, where their residential areas, people doing 40, 50 miles an hour, there are cars that will park along the side, and you know you can't get your car off of the boulevard. So you'll have people walking on both sides of the boulevard, and you'll have bikes coming down in the, you know, they're right in the dirt lane now, but they'll have to come out into Ocean Boulevard. And I've just seen too many close calls, and I would say for the Ocean Boulevard, unloading and loading, fine, I agree with that. Not being able to bring that plasma in your house, that's a problem. But other than that, it just creates a problem on Ocean Boulevard, especially in North Beach. But I would definitely not touch the businesses. You don't want to hurt a business in town.
So are you? Is it your suggestion that the 10-minute parking be eliminated in North Beach? Is that what you're saying?
I would rather see it made a loading-unloading area.
Okay.
Or be enforced the 10 minutes.
Okay.
Good evening. My name is Jerry Flynn. I live at 779 Ocean Boulevard at the corner of Ocean and 6th. And I bring a little bit of a different perspective to this. I've lived here for 10 years. I retired earlier this year after 32 years with the Lowell Police Department. And there's a walkway in front of my house that goes to the beach. And the police department does a great job up here as far as traffic enforcement. As a matter of fact, my son, for the last 2 years, has been a parking person that goes around and gives tickets. And I will tell you that on 6th Street and the surrounding streets as they go up, and I'm talking from 1 all the way up to 18, we should be more concerned about the parking on the side streets, which now become parking on both sides, which now... you could not get any kind of apparatus, God forbid there's a fire or something else along that nature. But more importantly, specific to what we're talking about today, if you look at what happens on Ocean Boulevard, they're flying past those intersections where the people are crossing the street. At the end of 6th Street is a large commercial trailer park. Sorry, Chief. Thank you. Trailer park, which, matter of fact, my brother and my mother live there. And people will walk by there, and I cannot tell you how many times that I've seen people almost get killed in front of my house. Now, if you put parking in front of my house or allow people to park in front of my house, I'll tell you right now, I will be sitting here a year from now telling you there have been 3 people killed up there. So, with all due respect, there is no way on God's green earth that we should be putting in. And if you want to allow parking, I've heard a couple people already talk about having parking, then open it up to the residents. If this is truly about money, that's why we want to do this, which I hope it's not. But if that's what it is, then give the people who live in those communities who are paying the taxes in that community the opportunity to park their car there. I've had people come over and the police department's going and ask me to move my car. Absolutely, move your car. But don't sit around, and I'll tell you right now, you're flirting with danger right now, as far as I'm concerned. And I think the more important factor is the side streets that aren't being addressed, and I think that's the thing that we should be looking at. Thank you.
Jerry, just one comment. It's not about money. It was purely about looking into the issue and finding out we didn't have the proper formal ordinances and documentation with the state, number one. And then number two, if we're going to go ahead and do that, let's make sure it's the existing thing is what we want to do. But you talked about parking, whatever. It appears to me that in the area where you are, there is, in fact, 10-minute parking there today. Is that
yes, there is. That's correct.
Okay.
There is. Yeah.
Okay.
And believe me, I have no problem with that as it is.
It's just longer term.
Right. I mean, I don't want to see it so it's open to open season where anybody can just park there. You're flirting with danger.
Right. Okay. And just what it's worth, I don't believe anybody had suggested that the time frame be extended from 10 minutes to a longer time frame, whatever. Anybody else from the public? Arthur?
Art Moody, 3 Thompson Road. I find it very convenient to have those 10-minute parking spaces because I take a lot of pictures. When the alternative is paid parking, those are great. And, of course, there's always a Powerball at Bill Lally's run in and run out.
Thank you, Arthur. Anyone else from the public? Tim?
When it comes to the Ocean Boulevard, Route 1A, as far as I can tell, the property is owned by the state of New Hampshire, not the town of Hampton. I would oppose the town of Hampton getting involved in maintaining, regulating state property. It's the state's responsibility. Let the state handle it. This town should do nothing. Leave it alone. Thank you.
Someone else? Okay. Seeing none, back to the board. Comments, suggestions, questions, statements?
I had a question for the lady that was about 3 or 4 back that lived up on the North Beach someplace. Mm-hmm. I didn't quite catch what her position is about parking in front of her house. The lady that came up and spoke about 4 or 5 people back?
Yeah, she's coming up.
Why don't you come up here? I just have a question for you, ma'am. I heard what you said, but I didn't quite understand what your position is about the 10-minute parking.
I think it should be enforced.
Enforced.
I do. Because
do you like the 10-minute parking, then?
The 10-minute parking, yes.
Okay, and
yes.
You live about between which streets up there again?
It's 833. I think it's between 11th and 12th. I'm pretty sure that's where it is. It's my parents' house, and I'm up there regularly. And like I said, I think that there's an issue if somebody's coming and going 10 minutes, to unload a load, but it's not. It's constant. There's some constant
parking there.
Yes. And it's not just the 20 feet from the intersections because my parents' house, they're in the middle, so I don't think if you put the 20 buffer from the side, it would still be an impact on them because they're in the middle of that.
Okay.
So that was my position.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Right now, as it stands, if I'm understanding this correctly, we can't enforce anything because we don't have the proper laws in place and the state hasn't agreed to it, correct?
State's position is that unless they approve an ordinance recommended by the selectmen, which they will do if you recommend one, there is no parking, period. Mm-hmm. Their position is there is no parking unless otherwise designated by parking stalls on state highways. So that's not really a remedy to this problem.
No.
Okay. The issue here is, should we have 10-minute parking there, which has been there for 30 or 40 years, maybe 50 years, or shouldn't we? If we should, then we need to make the signs legal. Right. Then the police can enforce it. As it stands right now, there is no state regulation regarding parking on the North Beach.
Just to be clear, what we've been enforcing, and again, this isn't a high priority for us.
Right.
We go up when there's complaints or we see a safety violation.
Yeah.
We don't have, and we've been lucky enough for several years to have a couple of young people that go out and we assign them to do the parking enforcement to deal with it. We'll need to keep that going if we're going to have consistent enforcement. So the other issue is there is a state statute that says essentially a posted sign is presumed to be accurate and enforceable. That's sort of what we've been using. Fred's right in that when someone appeals it, if someone does, and I can't say I've recalled ever having a ticket we issued that someone, you know, appealed on this issue, we wouldn't have any real solid backing on that. I'd rely on that statute that says a posted sign is accurate, but the records with regard to the state posting the signs and saying, yes, we officially put them up there, I mean, that's nebulous. It's a problem for us. And I think that's the goal here, was to really solidify what's out there, not necessarily change anything dramatically, but say what's out there and how are we having the proper backing for that. When we were asked, we added our safety concerns to what our issues are. How we address that's fine.
Okay. Mary Louise?
This somewhat goes back to what Mr. Bean has been complaining about, the state dumping all this stuff on us always. We're placed in a position where we're supposed to enforce something. I think I said last week, or well, whatever our last meeting was, that basically I just say the heck with the whole thing and let the state worry about it. Leave it alone and let the state worry about it. I don't want to have our officers placed in a situation where they're enforcing something predicated on signs that somebody put up, and we don't know who, and the state won't step in. And I think it's a dreadful mess. And actually, I have to say that I agree with Tim Jones. My inclination would be to leave it alone, let the situation handle itself. If the state wants to step in and enforce it, fine. We do need to take a look at the numbered streets and fire lanes and fire safety and whatever in there. But I see no reason to burden the Hampton Police Department. If it seems that most of this is self-enforcing, people running in and out, hopping in and out to the businesses, not really tying things up.
South of Rocky Bend, I think that's true. We don't really have a problem south of Rocky Bend.
Yeah.
But the north of Rocky Bend, and mostly it's really from, you know, even 3rd, 4th Street, it has enough space off the road. It's not really a traffic concern.
Right.
It's the issues as you get up further when the sites between, as were described by folks,
those
homes, some of them, they're in the roadway. That's the problem from our point of view.
Can we pass out information to the residents in that area with the correct contact number for the state of New Hampshire?
Here's my only problem. If we are not going to enforce it, nothing will happen.
Yes. Well,
so I will park there, I can park my car there, and we won't enforce it.
Yeah.
No one from the state has authority to enforce it. It won't get enforced, and people will just do exactly what these folks are saying.
Yeah.
They're parking there long periods of time. It will be dangerous and unsafe.
Correct.
That's a problem that I wouldn't recommend we go down.
But that's a state highway.
I don't disagree with that.
That's a state highway.
I don't disagree with that.
And if we give everybody the telephone number and they're calling Concord all summer long and DOT or whoever's responsible, maybe somebody wake up there. Because it's unacceptable to have situations like that in those neighborhoods north. I agree with that.
But if we, my only concern is if we take that position and we say we're not doing anything, they pull those signs down, then you're going to have the Wild Wild West and no one's going to be happy. What we've been doing, the 10-minute zone stuff, has been working. It's a pain in the tail for us from time to time, but it's working. So I don't know why we have to change dramatically from what we're doing there. I don't think we say we're washing our hands of it and going away. The reality is there's a lot of different places on state property that we deal with.
Mm.
It's a practical reality of running a safe community for us, and I don't see it being beneficial for us. While I agree with the sentiment, as a boots-on-the-street kind of guy, as an operational thing, I think that's a recipe for disaster that I'm not willing to say we get on that path.
So leave things alone from Boar's Head south, because they're self-policing pretty much, is that...
Again, none of this stuff's been a huge problem. We have problems. I agree completely that another project you want to bite off is we deal with the numbered streets, side streets. Absolutely, we need to do that.
Yeah.
But on Ocean Boulevard, why don't we just identify where those zones have always been, what they're posted out there, and submit that, and we're done. That takes care of the legal issue. Nothing's changed from anybody in the businesses. We're done. We don't have to create a problem.
Good.
Well, there isn't one.
Good.
Phil, Mark,
because I appreciate the work that you put into this. I know... was a job.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I don't know the dignified birth of this issue and who brought it forward. It was not I, but I commend those who did bring it forward. Parking's important.
Thank you, Chief, to you and your department for the work you've done on this, Mr. Welch as well. I agree with the entire business community that has come in and spoken here this evening. They appear to be suffering death from 1,000 paper cuts, and it transcends virtually all of their operations and how they come in contact with the government of the town of Hampton, New Hampshire. Mr. Jones raises a point about state property, and that point is well taken as well. Further to the north, there are many people that rent out their properties, and they are as well business owners. They have guests. They need access to their property. They rent those properties out, and they too are business owners. Folks that don't rent their properties out have guests, and they park. And it's a beach, and it's summertime, and we all have to get along. Adding more studies and more laws and more signs isn't going to make anybody happier, and it's going to make a lot of people a lot poorer. So I would tally up the numbers of the buildings on this study, and they're in the hundreds and hundreds when you count condominium units. There have been one or two people that have spoken eloquently and fairly and compassionately about safety needs and about their concerns. And we have a great law enforcement team here. We've got a great fire department here. I like to go to that beach and walk, and I see our departments interacting with property owners and the tourists and the customers, and I don't think the system's broken, and I think it ought to remain unchanged. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Okay. I'm prepared to make a motion.
I just want to point out one more thing that does concern me, especially when I was listening to Mr. Windermiller. We have been so short-sighted in this community for all that we offer, for all the business that's conducted. We have been so short-sighted on the parking issue that it's killing us. It's a dreadful detriment to this town to have the lack of parking facilities that we have, both off-street and then in the public way.
Okay, I'm prepared to make a motion, and that motion is that we solidify essentially the situation as we have it today with the 10-minute parking in the locations where that exists, that we turn that into an ordinance for approval by the selectmen, communicate that ordinance to the state, and then accordingly, as we work through that process, mark off the signs appropriately, again, consistent in the manner they are today. Does that make sense, Fred? Or
makes sense.
I just want to clarify one thing. Okay. Is there are places where those signs existed previously on the numbered streets I'm talking about now, where some of them are gone. Is your intention to leave those alone and not have that zone be there? Because, you know, some of those were there and they disappeared. I guess that's the only question I have in your motion. I get the south of the board, no issues. Those numbered streets where that 10-minute existed, some of those signs are gone. They don't exist.
Numbered streets on the numbered streets or
nope,
on Ocean
on the boulevard.
Boulevard.
Say, and just off the top of my head, say between, like, you know, 11th and 12th Street, there is no sign, but from 12th to 13th, there is. And, you know, and it's curiously tied to those areas where we see people parking their cars for more extended periods of time.
Well,
the question for you is, how do you want to handle those
I
as you put it in front?
I would think that the ordinance and ultimately the signage should reflect what was supposed to be there and was there at one time.
Reflect consistency.
Right.
I don't know what that is.
Yeah. I mean, the
because
thing would be
saying
to me
is
would
those
be
are the areas where we have the problems because there is no 10-minute only sign.
Yeah. There's only a couple of places we've had problems, Dick.
Right.
You know, and I think I think I get the intent of where you're going with that, and I can talk to Fred. I think we can put together something that meets your need. Maybe we come back to it, show it to you so you're satisfied before we submit it to the state. But I think I get where you're going. Basically, what I'm hearing is we turn that whole North Shore area, the numbered streets area, into a shorter-term loading zone,
right,
and everything
right.
south is a 10-minute parking zone. Right. Is that seem accurate from what I'm hearing from everybody?
Yes. I'd like to amend that to make everything above Boar's Head, right, Chief? Above Boar's Head?
North of Boar's Head is what?
Or above 6th Street.
I would say the numbered street. So in my mind, I'm using Winnicott to High Street as one thing,
High Street,
and south
have
of Winnicott
zone
enough.
Only, not 10-minute parking. That way it'll make it easy for the chief to enforce it, and it'll only be temporary parking. It won't be forever.
Is that more sensible than 10-minute parking, loading zone?
The six one half dozen the other. Your loading zone, you'd want active loading, unloading. They're the same basic thing.
Okay. But you have no way of checking easily the 10-minute.
Again, this should be really clear. We are not out there on that level dealing with it. No.
Right. Exactly.
Okay. Do we have a second?
Well, do you want to
incorporate that?
I'm fine with that.
You want to incorporate that in your motion?
I'm fine with that.
Okay. I'll second.
You second.
I'll second you, Mr. Nichols, but one more consideration. When we do put this together and send it to the state of New Hampshire, I want it clearly understood that by doing these things, by setting up the ordinance and clarifying the parking, that we accept absolutely no responsibility in any way, shape, or form for 1A. And this is a local convenience for us to keep law and order, but we want nothing on our shoulders from the state of New Hampshire. We want nothing implied.
It's not a taking.
Right. Yeah. Right.
Okay. All in favor? Opposed? Abstained. Motion passes 4-1-0 with being opposed. Okay. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you. It helped a lot to have you in.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Rich and James.
No, you can have that, Skip, if you need it.
Okay, public comment period. Somebody from the public wish to comment? Arthur, did I see a hand?
Are the police clearing the room?
Yes.
They're going to take you with them.
I always listen to what you have to say, so I'm staying.
Oh, he's actually waiting to take you with him.
I'll try to get you in there somehow. My comments are completely away from the beach.
Ah.
I mean, as far as town government is concerned, I read yesterday's Seacoast Sunday op-ed piece by Judy Silva, Esquire, Municipal Association, Executive Director, and Steve Fournier, a member of the Board of Directors of the New Hampshire Municipal Association. And some of the things I was not surprised at, for instance, yes, town meeting did ask tree warden through the Municipal Association to draft something. Yes, people have been involved with the pensions and the spiking. This board and the officials with the Municipal Association to draft bills and so forth. Mm-hmm. And there are other things. Well, they said that all members of the legislative delegation last year, which I assume is 5 plus 1, state senator, were in favor of simplifying the Senate Bill 2 process on the ballot for adopting or amending non-zoning town ordinances. And that did pass last year, but we haven't followed it. The five ordinances that are on the warrant to be voted on didn't follow that process, so I don't know the legality of what we're doing. However, the thing that surprised me was that Representative Munns and Rice were getting them to simplify town charter process. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't think the legislature pays dues to the Municipal Association, and I'm not sure that that came from this board or from town meeting. And it sounded like it did. I know Mr. Rice has been opposed to the charters proposed. He's been holding signs at the polls against the last one, which took all the power, virtually all the power, and put it in a town council, mm-hmm. C-O-U-N-C-I-L.
Mm-hmm.
And he is a military retiree, not a retiree, but he's served as a military from West Point. And I know that late last year I heard that the town Democratic chairman, Dick DeRocious, had tried to get advice on a charter proposal for this year's town meeting. I don't know if he's given access to town council or not, but I know the developers certainly have their attorneys, out-of-town attorneys, out-of-town developers certainly have direct access to town council. But I feel that the Municipal Association executive director should be informed that what Mr. Munns is doing and Mr. Rice is doing to simplify something on the charter process didn't come from town government, as far as I know.
I don't know
Munns's involvement specifically, unless Dick DeRocious asked him to, being of the same party. But I'd like this board to inform them that it's not a town function so far to simplify the process. And I'm against giving up my right to vote on every matter, whether I'm in town at the time or not on election day. And I know what's been produced. I was on the last Charter Commission. And Mrs. Woolsey and I were the two who opposed it. It was cost $25,000 just for the attorney, outside attorney, who goofed a number of times. But, yeah, that surprised me. It's very surprising that I think I don't know if the town, if the selectmen were, never came before the board, asked to put that article in this year or not, but once is enough every 20 years to go through that process, I think. The last one, I think it was 2000. Thanks.
Thank you, Arthur. Somebody else from the public.
Mr. Chairman, before we go on to the next speaker, we're not supposed to interact with the speakers.
I know, that's why I caught myself.
Okay, I mean, I understand that. I wanted to say something, too, but now that he's done speaking, can we speak on that issue, or should we wait till they're all done talking?
Why don't we wait till they're all done, Mike?
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You can speak on that. I have a different topic.
Go ahead, Tim.
Okay. I come here tonight not for the parking, but because I'm concerned with what I'm seeing going on in government in general on a local level. Mm-hmm. Particularly what's concerning to me, I just wanted to bring to light a few things. The Hampton Beach Village District, which is a separate government entity I know, is actually using taxpayer money to fund a political campaign against a citizen's warrant article, which I find abhorrent. Of course, the citizen's warrant article they're opposing is Mary Louise's Article 43. Mm-hmm. This board voted 4-1 against that article. I on the budget, well, I at the deliberative session made my point clear. I'm also opposed to that warrant article. But even more opposed than that warrant article, my opposition stands against using taxpayer money to brainwash the public. I mean, this is absolutely nauseating. I hope this board, although just like the Village District Commissioners voted in opposition to the Article 43, and this board voted 4-1 against it. I hope this board doesn't see precedence there, decide to start using town taxpayer money for such propagandizing. I've also seen some concerns relative to the IT policy, which was brought to light a week or two ago, and was described in the paper as NSA-like. Which was a bit concerning to me, not only the description. I was familiar with the policy, had a small amount of input at the time. But when I look at that and I look at the planning board and their activities, I see that the town manager has placed the town planner on leave. paid leave, paid vacation, you know, pay them not to work. And then I hear the vice chairman of the planning board telling the Hampton Union that it's the planning board that hires and fires them, but apparently it's the town manager that puts them on leave. I mean, what kind of management structure is that? I don't understand that at all. It doesn't make any sense. And when it comes to timing, the timing of it is appalling to me because Jamie was in responding to a request of mine, a 91A request, a right-to-know request, and relative to the semi-secret laws that the board of, the planning board was putting forth. Within one work day later, he's put on leave. Now, he responded via email. And when I bring that together, the NSA-like policy, I have to ask a basic question. Was the town manager reading Jamie's email or any metadata from it? This is very disturbing to me. What is even more disturbing is that apparently now that we've put someone on paid leave, this is normally a precursor to what? Firing a guy. And typically what happens is you negotiate something, give him a little money to put a muzzle on him so he doesn't tell you what took place. That's going to result in what? An empty town planner position. But you look at the history of the creation of this town planner position. This town planner position was put forth in a warrant article 3 years in a row. 3 years in a row it failed. 2 years in a row it failed by more than a 2-to-1 vote. On the third failure, you know, in the America I know, three strikes and you're out, but not here in town government. No, no, no. On the third strike, you're not out, you're in, because right after that vote, that third no, we hired a town planner. So as far as I'm concerned, the town planner's position itself is illegal. So if it becomes vacant, I'm asking you, don't fill it until you get a yes vote from the town, at least, please. Let the voters actually be heard for once. Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else from the public? Seeing none. Announcements and community calendar. Mike?
I wanted to comment.
I'm sorry, yep. Go ahead.
That's okay. If I may, in response to Arthur's question about the SB2 situation and the councilman form of government, Arthur, a selectman was on this board when I first got here. Unbeknownst to this board, asked the LGC to consider that when they went to the legislature. And I happen to have the misfortune of being appointed to be the representative to that group. And when I got there, it was on the agenda from Hampton. From Hampton, Arthur, okay? And that really got my attention because I don't like the whole idea to start with. I really didn't like that somebody pulled a sneak like that on me.
Yeah.
And I'm really upset about that. So I think we ought to move on. As far as I'm concerned, the LGC should not move on that, but they are working on it because there was a vote at their meeting to decide what to on their agenda for the next year, and that got passed overwhelmingly at that meeting. At their own meeting from all the reps from all the towns. And it was started right here.
Okay. Announcements and community calendar. Mike?
Yes, I have a couple. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The first one I want to mention is, as you people know, I've been involved with that advisory committee looking at the downtown area. Well, the Experience Hampton and Hampton Chamber of Commerce are going to have a meeting Wednesday the 26th, which is this week, 2 days from now, at the Pelican Club from 5 to 6:30 to talk about what we want to look at downtown. Just want to make sure everybody's aware of that. And I would specifically ask all of you gentlemen and ladies to attend if you want to. So that takes care of that one. I have one more about...
Mike, just for clarification, the Pelican Club is in the galley hatch, correct?
Yes, it is. I'm sorry. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It is. It's the upstairs part of the galley hatch. And the second issue I'd like to bring up is March 11th, as everybody knows, is voting day in Hampton. And I think it's very important for the voters to get out and vote this time because there's a lot of articles on the ballot that are somewhat up for discussion, I think one could say. And there's also some quite a few people running for the various offices. And I think that all the voters in Hampton would be doing themselves a service by getting out and voting this time. Maybe not so much in the past, possibly, but this time I think it's very important for everybody to get out and vote, because the number of selectmen that are up for re-election this time, it could change the majority of this board from going where we've been going for a while to some different direction, whatever that may be. And I think it's very important for all the voters to get out and register their sentiments with the warrant articles and all the candidates. There's also some other issues on the ballot. The school board has an opening, and I think there's some other issues with the budget committee. So I think everybody should get out and vote if they possibly can. If you need a ride, I'll come and get you.
Uh-oh.
Okay, Phil?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The weather's been typically New England-y the last couple of weeks, and it was incessant. And our Public Works Department, our Fire Department, our Police Department, and the Headquarters Element stepped right up, and they've done a beautiful, beautiful job. And it's been tiresome. It's been expensive. It's going to strain certain parts of budget. It's going to strain our infrastructure. And they're out. It's day on, stay on, and they really did a magnificent job. And Mr. Welch, if you could please pass that on to your people. Thank you.
Okay, Mike?
Bill, all set.
Mary Louise?
Yeah, regarding what Phil just said, too, the DPW budget is going to be really stretched already before we've even had a chance to vote. It's really important to vote to support the budget. And I agree with your sentiments, Mike, but not just this year. Every year I had the opportunity to talk to a wonderful young man who had been stationed in Afghanistan and just came back home and is really, really relieved to be back. And I feel badly that people, just not just the servicemen representing us, but other people, for example, in Ukraine and in the Ukraine and other countries are dying for the right to do what we take for granted. So I hope we see a big turnout at the polls.
I would just add to what Mary Louise said, a couple of numbers that last year I found very disappointing. Last year only 2,400, mm-hmm. 24, I think it was, 2,400 plus people voted, as opposed to roughly 3,500 the previous year, and I think 3,100 in 2011, and
yeah.
That's kind of abysmal when you compare it to in a presidential election in the neighborhood of 8,500 or 9,000 people have voted, and your vote carries more weight, and obviously in a local election than it does
in
statewide or presidential or whatever. Okay, moving on to appointments. Ed Tinker, Chief Assessor. Ed?
Good evening.
How are you doing?
Two items. This year's lease land rent list is ready for your review and approval. Just to give you a heads up, we added one property to the actual list that pays the 2% land rent. We now have 33 that pay a land rent and four properties that are still under the old leases that will be starting in 17, one each year will be coming off that list and being added to the 2%.
Good.
So there's four left to go.
Mr. Chairman, will you accept a motion to accept the 2014 leased land rent?
Yeah, I will second that, and I will also point out that the total amount is $167,624, correct?
Correct. Yep.
Any further discussion? All in favor? Unanimous. Okay, and you had a second item, Ed?
Yeah, the sewer abatement rate has been set, and the list has been sent to the board for their review and approval. This year's rate is 62 cents per thousand for a total refund amount of $105,139.
So move that we accept the 2014 sewer abatement rate.
And that amount is what, Ed?
62 cents per thousand.
62
per
what was the amount? 100 and
105, 139, 105,000.
The exact compared to something like 93 and 94,000.
Mm-hmm. Last year, correct.
Actually in the ballpark, up slightly. Right. I will second Mary's motion. Any further discussion?
Yep.
All in favor? Unanimous. That was easy.
Yeah.
Thank you, Ed.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, next appointment. Carl McMorrin and John Welch.
Yeah.
Did I get it right?
McMorrin.
McMorrin, I got it right. You corrected me last time and I remembered. From Aquarian.
They're the mix and then the masks. It depends on which clan you're in. Good evening, gentlemen. Hi, John. Yes, we did. Thank you, Carl.
How you doing, Mark? Okay.
Good evening, everyone. I'm John Walsh, Vice President of Operations, and you all know Carl McMorrin.
Yep.
Chairman Nichols, thank you very much for having us here this evening. Tonight, we just wanted to give you an update on our infrastructure investment in 2013 and plan for 2014. Now, do you all have the presentation that we sent along? Okay.
Yep.
So, first one to start with the projects that we constructed under in 2013 under the WICA program, or the Water Infrastructure and Conservation Adjustment Program. So that's the second page of the presentation. Mm-hmm. And in 2013, we spent about $738,000. On replacement of water mains, services, hydrants, and valves. Most of that $738,000 was on the replacement of water mains on Church Street, Auburn Ave, and Auburn Ave Extension, and Perkins Ave. And typically, under the WICA program, the cost associated with all those replacements would be reflected in rates in the form of a surcharge starting on January 1, so 2 months ago. But if you remember last time we were here, we had indicated that we were going to postpone asking for that surcharge to be implemented. Recently, we have filed with the DPU asking for the surcharge to be implemented starting on April 1st. The surcharge that we've requested is 1.4%, and that's to cover the cost of those projects done in 2013. And that comes to about 58 cents a month for the average customer in Hampton. Now, although we've asked for the surcharge to be implemented effective April 1st, we are also asking that the surcharge not be reflected on the customer bills until next January. And the reason for that is that we are also planning to file with the DPU and ask for a credit to be started on customer bills starting next January as well. And that credit is the result of changes in the tax law. The result of those changes is that we'll get a tax benefit. Right now we're in the midst of calculating what that tax benefit is for the years 2007 through 2013. Once we calculate that, we'll file within the next 3 to 4 weeks with the PUC asking for that credit to be implemented starting in January. So the surcharge, the WICA surcharge, would increase bills. The credit will decrease bills by a greater amount. We didn't want to see an increase in bills in April and then a decrease coming in January. So we figured we'd hold off on the WICA surcharge until January. The net effect will be a decrease in people's bills, customers' bills, starting next January.
Would you prefer to take? You've actually got two separate years here that you're covering. Would you prefer to take questions at the end or at the end of each year, or whatever?
I think it's best if we do questions now as we go through it.
Okay. Any questions? Or?
Thank you.
I have a couple. As I looked, I compared some of the numbers with another sheet. I assume your handout that you're familiar with that we received from Aquarian dated January 11th.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, I can't see that from here.
But anyway, let me continue and, sure. And see if it makes sense of this. What I'm seeing here is 2013, $737,738,000 in Hampton. Now, what I also saw on this list was an additional $1.73 million in Northampton.
Those are main replacement projects from prior years.
Okay. And that's listed in 2013 then for Northampton. When the rates are set, can you explain how projects in Hampton versus Northampton affect the rates? Is it basically the entire amount of the expenditures are reflected in the rates and applied to both towns? Is that?
Yes, there's one rate class regardless of town. There's no
right.
Difference.
So the Northampton ratepayer is absorbing Hampton repairs and improvements and vice versa or whatever. Okay. What in terms of this 1.4% surcharge, what is the principal amount driving the 1.4%? Is it like, for example, if I look on this January 11th handout, there's a number of combining Northampton and Hampton, $2.433 million. Is that the principal amount that's driving the calculation of the one that arrives at 1.4%?
I believe it's the $737,875.
Yes.
So the 1.730 from Northampton is not part of the 2013.
Right, that was a prior year WICA charge.
Okay. In terms of this 2013 WICA charge, what is the source of the financing? In other words, is it bonded debt? Is it equity?
It's a combination.
Okay.
Of equity and debt.
And what is the rate, the interest rate that that combination ends up at, roughly?
I don't know that off the top of my head. I can get that to you.
Okay, that would be fine. Okay. And the time frame over which that is financed, I remember at one point in our last meeting, I recall you mentioning a time frame like 88 years. Is that?
The depreciation rate for our water mains is 88 years.
Okay. Yeah. So you'll get back to us with the percentage, and this 1.4% charge is based on a straight line depreciation over 88 years then.
Yes, for the water mains. The other assets, which aren't as much
right,
in
right.
terms of dollar
yeah.
volume, have different yeah. depreciation rates.
Right, okay. And the approach in terms of what goes on with the POC or whatever of, let's say, financing it over 88 years versus a shorter time frame, is do we end up at that 88-year time frame based on your requesting that time frame and they're approving it, or they're requiring a time frame that's the useful life of the asset, or?
It's an industry standard. They set that depreciation period for whatever category of asset it is, mains or valves or anything else. So
kind of PUC calls the shots
they
in terms of the time frame.
Yep.
Okay, good. Thank you.
Right. I have some questions.
Okay,
for
sure.
Yeah. Welcome back.
How are you?
Good, and you?
All right.
There would otherwise, according to the petition supplemental materials filed on January 31, in the ordinary course, you would be seeking a surcharge of, it's 1.3788%. We'll call it 1.4%. But nevertheless, because of the tax benefit that's been achieved, you're going to be asking the commission to defer imposition of that till January?
Correct.
And so there will be an application, a credit. I know you've called it a surcredit. In the filings, an application of a portion of the tax benefit to that? Is that an offset? Can you explain how that works?
Well, we're doing a filing within the next 3 to 4 weeks that'll explain the surcredit and the details behind it and the amount of the surcredit and the number of years over which there's a tax benefit that we'll be getting back for 2007 through 2013. And that then gets distributed back to customers through the surcredit for a number of years, and that number of years has not been worked out yet.
Yeah. Okay, so that because of the way this is working for this 1 year, we won't be seeing if the commission approves it, we won't be seeing the surcharge on the bills.
Correct. Yeah. What customers will see starting in January is the combination of the WICA surcharge and what we're referring to as a SIR credit, with the net effect being a decrease in the bills.
Sure. There is a aggregate cap between rate cases of 7.5%. The way the WICA program, which is a pilot, is set up, along with an annual cap of 5%. Will the 1.4% nevertheless be counted toward the 7.5%?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Even if it's not charged for?
Correct. I believe that WICA surcharge and the credit will actually show up as separate line items in the bill, but I don't think we've gotten into those details. So that 1.4% will go against the 7.5%.
Sure.
That cap.
The company had substituted project to the momentary chagrin of the PUC, Auburn Ave, Perkins Ave, and Auburn Ave Extension, to accommodate basically our approach to doing those,
yes,
which I thought was very good. I don't know why they were so mystified by it, but it was replacing lines that
right.
were 50 plus years old and had caused problems.
Right.
It would have met the criteria you normally choose to select such a thing, but that's not a problem at this point for the commission, as far as you're concerned.
I think that's been addressed, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. They did create a mechanism whereby if there are to be such substitutions that they be come to their attention earlier than they did.
Mm. Correct.
But it was really a combination of the way we did that project and they're realizing some savings from working with us that that led to that. So that was very, very good.
Mm-hmm.
You haven't got compliments from that.
Oh,
but we do. We compliment you for
thank you very
saving.
Much.
We appreciate it.
Okay.
All set.
Do you want to move on to 2014?
Yep. So for 2014, we do plan to continue replacing infrastructure under the WICA program. And we have received approval to spend about a little over $1 million on main replacements that Carl will discuss in a little more detail in a minute or two. But included in that as well is some hydrant service line and valve replacements. With that, I'm going to hand it over to Carl to talk about our capital program in total for 2014.
So I've given you a presentation. There's a table on the left that basically shows our capital budget for the year. We're less than 2 months in, so we've got some things in motion, but we haven't really tabulated any cost to any significant extent. And included a map of our major main replacement project, which will be out on Ocean Boulevard from Winneconnet Road down to Dumas Avenue. There's actually two mains there. This is the ocean side main. It's strictly a transmission main, so we don't affect any services. Really, there'll be a couple of hydrants that would be out a little bit. It's about 2,100 feet, and we're using trenchless technology, so we're not going to be tearing up the whole length. There'll be probably four or five, maybe six pits that they'll dig, and then we'll basically burst the new pipe through the pathway of the old one.
Wow.
So, cuts costs, cuts down a lot of the disruption that goes along with these types of projects.
Is that the old 1907 line, Carl?
Yes, it is.
That we're finally getting to? Yeah? Literally, 1907.
We had a couple of nasty breaks on that, just since I've been here. So.
Yeah.
What did they make it out of the 1907
iron.
That lasted that long?
Cast iron.
Cast iron,
it's pretty good stuff.
But I guess so.
Did you do some trenchless replacements on Church Street?
Yes, we did.
Okay.
Same technology.
So I can't think of the name of the company, but I saw that going on. Okay, thank you.
And going on to the next page is just a little bit more breakdown on the main replacement projects that we have in mind. I mentioned Ocean Boulevard. Hopefully, will be off and running in mid-April,
good.
And certainly done by Memorial Day at the absolute latest.
Wow.
hopefully sooner than that. The Boar's Head Terrace project really isn't on Boar's Head Terrace. if you're on Ocean Boulevard, before you turn right on the terrace, there's an alley that goes up, and that there's a main that comes down through there. Back in the good old days, I don't think any of you are probably old enough, remember there was a standpipe up there, the very first one in the system, and that was the transmission main down to the beach. So it's there, and if you look up that alley, you can see a chain link fence. Our main is right underneath that, and it's too narrow to get any mechanized equipment in when it breaks. So our idea is to get it relocated and out of service before that happens.
Who does that supply water to, that alley, besides me? I guess my question is that also supplying water to Boar's Head Terrace, or is it just...
Well, all the houses on the south side of Boar's Head Terrace, the service lines come off that, and then I think it's Great Boar's Head Ave, which...
That's my road, yeah.
Okay. Those come off from that main as well. So there's a couple of dozen services off that main.
Now that's going to be out for 6 months, right?
He's got the ocean out front. He can lower buckets.
There you go.
Okay, so that essentially, that alley doesn't provide all of Boar's Head Terrace then?
No, it does not. There's actually another main on Boar's Head Terrace, so people on that side, we can just shift the service lines over.
Right.
It's people on your street, there'd be a little bit more of a challenge.
Right.
So we hope to have an engineering firm working on this soon to work out the details.
Okay, thank you.
The two at the bottom are really just design. They're almost a placeholder. At this point, they're high enough on the priority list that we're looking at them.
Yeah.
But come midsummer, when we reevaluate all of our main replacement projects, they might move. But, as it stands now, we'll probably do some preliminary work on that.
Carl, one question on those two. I noticed on this January 11th list that I referenced, Ross Ave had $267,000 associated with it, and now it's dropped down to $21,000. And then Gentian Green Meadow Pond was $447,000. And it's dropped down to 35, so I'm assuming that the January 11th was the entire plan with construction, whereas this, you've kind of shifted years a little and it backed off.
This is what we expect to spend just this year.
Right, mm-hmm. Right. Okay.
The next table is just a tally of the activities we performed last year to operate and maintain the water system, just to give you a sense of everything that we do, everything that goes into running the water system. If you have any questions on that, then the last slide is just a couple of things we're doing. Community relations program, we're partnering with with the Conservation Commission on the Rain Barrel project again this year. We're donating 8 to the Academy for their painting project. If you've seen those in the past, those are really awesome, and some of them will be auctioned off at the Garden Club plant sale in May. And this year, we're also rolling out Environmental Champions Award. This is really to recognize some outstanding volunteer work in our community that benefits both the water resources in particular, which is important to the water supply, but also the environment in general. And we're going to be awarding $1,000 awards in 4 categories for the top business, top nonprofit, adult, and the student. And what we'll do is we'll donate that $1,000 to the charity of choice for the first 3 categories. The student, Fred, if you want to go back to college, you can get $1,000 towards your
Good.
And the list of the website.
I buy a sweater today.
Yeah. I put the website for nominations there for your reference.
Great.
Okay, any questions?
I got one. Sitting here just thinking about what we're talking about and the credit that's going to come for the wicker charge. How long is the credit? How many years does the credit last? 88?
No.
It's going to be somewhere to 2 to 3 years.
2 to 3 years.
Yeah. I don't know. We so haven't.
At the end of that, everybody's going to be paying a 1.4% surcharge forever. I mean, you don't pay your debt, so the only thing you pay is interest. And I'm assuming that from your testimony of the PUC when you say you never pay your principal, you never pay your principal. Even when, and you don't do that on a on an 88-year frequency basis. At the end of 88 years, the principal's still there, and it continues to run for another 88 years.
The difference between what we do and most private corporations yep. like this and a town is that the money that a town would use to pay down principal, we reinvest that.
No, I understand. I understand you reinvest those dollars.
Yes.
Instead of paying the principal down. But that means that these rates go on forever, and they never go down, except for maybe 1 or 2 or 3 years where you get a credit someplace. And then all of a sudden, 3 years from now, there's going to be a 1.4% pancake on top of something else.
Yeah, the alternative would be if we did pay down our principal, we would have to issue new debt. Mm. So it's a yep. municipalities and private corporations handle debt differently. Municipalities do single issue debt and pay it down over time. Instead of paying down debt, corporations, instead of going through the hassle of reissuing new debt for every activity that you need debt for, you take the money that you would use to pay down debt and you use that money to reinvest.
Now, I understand the principle. That's, yeah. It's fairly uniform in private business, particularly private utilities. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. My concern is what I said to the PUC, and that is that as you borrow, that line just keeps on going up and up and up and up and up as far as the amount you owe. And the rates that are formulated on that continue to go up forever. They never come back down.
As long as what it's really tied to is what our rate base, and we're getting into regulatory terms here, but if we invest in the infrastructure at the same level as our depreciation rate, mm-hmm. Then the rates will, separate from the expense side of our business, just the capital investment side of our business, the rates will stay the same. The only way that our rates increase mm-hmm. From capital investment is if we invest beyond that depreciation rate. So I'm probably getting into...
Which you're doing in this case because you've got the WICA.
Yes, yeah.
So until you replace the system, that's going to continue to go.
Yeah, one thing I like about the WICA, the WICA program, is we're in here at least once a year talking to you about it, and before we invest, we do want to know your feelings on whether or not we should be investing, and thus having 1 to 2% rate increases each year.
Well, no, I think that's a good idea that you come in.
Yeah.
I'm not faulting that at all. I'm concerned about the system as it stands, because that system as it stands could represent
the reduction tonight.
Hundreds of percentages rate increases over a long period of time. People can't afford to pay over an extended period of time.
Okay. 9.67.
So that's kind of where we are. Looking at the pro ratio coming off either the top of what you're talking about, in 15 years, 20 years, you could be doubling or tripling your rate.
Okay, Mary Louise.
Mm. Yeah, and I should say I do not expect that is going to be happening at all.
We don't want to.
Yeah, yeah. I think we've talked about this last time I was in.
Yep.
Our expectation and
talk about every time
our plan is that the next time we're for a rate increase, that we are not in asking for a double-digit rate increase.
Mary Louise?
We're seeing an old system that is being rehabilitated. I wish I could see the Hampton sewer system being rehabilitated at this rate, since we haven't passed a sewer bond since 1986, and all our sewer lines are crumbling. And I am really delighted to see the orderly progress of rehabilitation and new construction in what is a critical resource to this town, and that's the water. I sat on the Hampton Waterworks Advisory Council for a long time, and they were trying, but I am really impressed with what Aquarian has brought forward by means of serious structured, planned replacements and upgrades. And I am pleased with this, and I tell you, I'm not paying for my telephone or my oil or a lot of the other utilities what I was paying 10 or 20 years ago. So I don't think this is a frightening thought.
Mr. Chairman, if I may, I'd like to add a little comment to Mayor Louise's remarks. Aquarian is in business to make money.
That's right.
They are making money on their investment when they do this.
And they're benefiting
the town,
us while they're doing it.
The town is not in business to make money. Yeah. We charge the taxpayers for all the sewer things.
Mm-hmm.
If I was running a very frugal business and I was the water company, I could probably do it on a heck of a lot less than they're getting for return on their money when they get a return of 10% and the market's only returning about 1 or 2 or 3% on a good day. So I think you got your apples mixed up with the oranges, Mary Louise. Thank you.
Okay, we all set?
I have one of
Mark.
Of course, the WICA charge is a, it's not construction works in progress. It's charged after you've spent the money.
Mm-hmm. Right.
What I wanted to ask you was, several years ago, Aquarian refinanced $4 million of debt
and borrowed
an additional $1 million at a lower rate than had been in place before. Is any of that $1 million being used for the projects that you're, the 1.4% would be imposed for?
Do you know the answer?
No, I don't.
Not sure of the answer. I can get back to you on it.
Yeah, that would be good.
Okay.
I'd be interested in that. I'd be interested in how it's actually being financed. At times, Aquarian of New Hampshire borrows from its affiliates, and at times they borrow from Aquarian of New Hampshire, we've learned. Mm-hmm. So it'd be interesting to know how the, how what you're seeking to recover for was financed in the first place.
Equity versus debt and the rates and so
right.
on. And so
May
forth.
I ask Council, is this not similar to what the state of New Hampshire has done with the SRF funding? To complete the project first, and then you get your compensation from the state?
I think the
similar.
The SRF funding is, behind that is federal funds.
It's federal, and the reason they do it, it's the reason they do it that way is the state gets 10% of the cut
right.
of the federal funds.
Right, but it's still do the project first, and then you're
it's a federal requirement.
For your, yes.
Yeah. Okay, all set?
Mr. Chairman, Mayor, please.
Sure.
Gentlemen, good to see you tonight. Thank you for coming up. And as we read throughout the nation of places in West Virginia, we read about California, mm-hmm. where their economic future, their personal hygiene, their safety, their way of life is imperiled by a lack of a safe and reliable water source.
Yes.
I have come after some research and in some initial opposition to your company and your rate increases. And there's nothing wrong with businesses being in the business to make money. Those seems to be the ones that provide the best products in the end run. And I do thank you for coming here. I am gaining more confidence in your company the more I learn. I serve on your advisory council here in town. I've done my research. And when I look at the price of diesel for my 12-year-old car, I thought I was being smart, and it was about $1.50 a gallon. Now it's heading towards $5. I dare say that other energy sources and other means to our standard of living are exponentially with no safety net and
right.
comfort feeling that it's going to be available or where the price will end, that you allow us to participate in the discussions, go to the public utilities commissions, whether we get to testify or not, but to share that free information. And as Mary Louise says, we are a town that if our water supply is imperiled, the beach stops immediately, whether that's on July 4th. Our way of life in this town stops.
Yep.
Our property values plummet. Everything about our way of life in Hampton ceases, and you're a key component to that. And we really are blessed that you are using top-notch, state-of-the-art technology to improve your infrastructure and the projects you've described tonight. So, again, a vote of confidence, and I'm equally thankful for town manager who has considerable expertise and knowledge about municipal water sources and our town attorney for the legal process. And I think it's a great rub-off of ideas and sharing of information, and I want to thank you for coming up tonight. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You're welcome. Thank okay, you. Thank you very much.
Come back again sometime.
Yeah.
Thank
you. Okay, approval
thank you,
of
John.
February 3rd minutes.
Yeah, okay.
Page 1. Page 2. Page 3. Page 4. Page 5. Page 6. Top of page 6. Second line. Schedule the public hearing. Obviously for February 24th, not February 4th. Here it is tonight.
Two got left out.
Right. Typo. Page 7. Page 8. I would make a motion to approve the minutes as amended.
Second.
Seconded by Mike Clough. All in favor? Unanimous. Okay. Minutes of February 10th. Page 1. Page 2. Top of page 2, we again have Nick Reed, R-E-E-D, as opposed to R-E-I-D.
Say that again?
Page 3.
Hey, what did you say it was, Mr. Chairman?
Top of page 2.
Mr. Reed's name was misspelled.
Oh, okay. Go ahead.
Page 3. Page 3, fourth paragraph down, says Selectman Pierce asked if it would be draining into the pond under Barber Road. I think that was Nihilus Brook that right. was
yes.
what was.
Yes. Yes, it is. Right.
I believe that on the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7th paragraph down, see if you remember it this way, Fred, when we were talking about the work at Place Cove, associated with the boulders in front of the stairs and all that, that would be done in conjunction with the work on Northeast Lane.
Mm-hmm.
Northeast Lane.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That came from Chris Jacobs.
It did.
Now, that doesn't sound right. They're do nothing. Oh, do nothing in relation to mm-hmm. serving a function, the boulders yeah. themselves.
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead. I'll stop right.
Where are we here?
Okay, moving on to page 4.
On page 4, yes, at the top, there's a problem with the second paragraph. Selectman Pierce asked about the pumping station off Lafayette Road and the Torian up fence. It should be, leave out the E would help.
What?
Toward.
Torian. It's not Torian, it's Torn, without an E.
I was still on page 4.
Oh.
We are on page 4.
Yeah.
That's
page
5 of 8.
No, he's on
no.
page 4.
Page 4. The top of page 4.
Oh, the top.
Right side, yeah. third line
oh,
down.
Oh, torn up. Oh, torn. Yes. Okay. Okay. Gotcha.
I do pronounce words wrong once in a while, but I, yes. I don't think I did it that time.
Never know.
I've got a comment that's kind of a general comment to do with the minutes, mm-hmm. and I'll give mm-hmm. two examples that are on page 4 to make the point. I've seen this before, but it just struck me when I was going over it this weekend. We're putting questions that selectmen are asking in the minutes, but we're not putting the answers
yeah.
to the questions.
Oh, you should have the answers.
And,
yeah.
and I've been an advocate of trying to slim these down, so
yes,
I'm not worried about whether everything gets in there.
Right.
But if we're going to put a question, for example, Selectman Pierce, he wonders if Mr. Gingras goes around and inspects all these locations. He also asked if there are alarms at DPW to notify of the problems at the pump station.
Mm-hmm.
Farther down, Selectman Woolsey commented, asked if the two sledge trucks are being rotated, how the press is working beautifully. There was never an answer to whether or not the sledge truck. I think there was an answer in the meeting.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
My point is
but
just
the
so.
Is it in the middle?
But you've heard my comments on
there.
Minutes.
Huh? It should be
yeah,
there.
Yeah, if there's a question,
right.
there ought to be the answer. That,
yeah.
That's
right.
my point.
I like that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Page 5. Page 6. Page 7, last paragraph. It's Nichols, not Nicholas. That's first.
Oh, yeah, Nicholas. I
Nicholas
knew that.
Nicholas is in the audience.
I should have seen that one, too.
Yeah.
And page 8. Okay. I'll make a motion to approve the February 10th minutes as amended.
Second.
Seconded by Selectman Pierce. All in favor? Unanimous. Okay. Town Manager's Report. Fred?
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, the Finance Director has filed his impact fees report with the
yes.
school boards.
Yes.
We are currently holding for SAU 21, $45,481, and for SAU 90, $111,902. We're looking for them to send us the appropriate paperwork so we can begin the refund to them.
Excellent.
DPW winter snow expenditures for the month of January. Now, of course, this has been updated already, right. But for the month through January, we'd spent 30.5% of our total winter control budget for plowing and maintenance and hired equipment and salt.
I think we got our money's worth, though.
We did, but we're now up to over 80% of that expended, and the hired equipment budget is overdrawn.
Just make sure we leave some money for the potholes.
Different account.
Yeah.
Different account. But since we've had...
That'll be over, too.
We've had snow the first half of February every other day.
Yeah.
Yes.
And
some of it has been a little more than most of us wanted to move.
Yeah.
So as long as things quiet down a bit, we'll be okay, I think. But we're going to run over for winter next to the end of the year.
Yeah. How are we for salt?
We received 300 tons today.
Oh, my.
So,
because everybody's been scrambling for salt.
We have been scrambling, too, just to make sure we can get it. And the state's the same way. One vendor, their entire salt pile is reserved at this point for the state of New Hampshire.
Oh, yeah.
The other one's reserved for both the state and municipalities. So we've been able to get salt on a regular basis.
Yeah. Good.
But private vendors have not been able to get it.
Okay.
So. Extensive work is ongoing on the Church Street pump station for completion of the station. And I had originally put in here what amounted to 3/4 of a page of material just dealing with what they're finishing up over there. And they're moving ahead rapidly.
Good.
They really are. They're doing a good job. And they're starting to wire for the pumps. They're doing just a terrific job.
So you think we're going to be pretty much on schedule for the extended?
Their completion date suggestion, which is coming up in another month and a half, total completion in May, they're on the ball. They'll be there. They're going to make that without a problem.
Good job. Thank you.
I put in here that the lease and rental agreement for Seawalls is in its final preparation stages. You have it in your handouts tonight.
Yeah. Yes,
for your review.
You.
So we're going to be in a position to discuss that then at next week's meeting?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Okay.
Yep. And that's it.
Okay, questions for Fred?
I have a question, comment, I guess, because Mr. Pierce just mentioned one of my favorite subjects, potholes. If we insist upon neglecting the roads in this community, we're going to end up with the nearly disastrous situation we are in now. It's a miracle there haven't been more accidents. The poor public works crews are out there patching the roads, which lasts a day or two, and then we're stuck again. The potholes on the Exeter Road are a disgrace. And I would hope we can see more of a focus in the coming year and years about an orderly maintenance and replacement schedule for the roads.
I have a question for the manager on that issue, more or less.
Sure.
I was out driving around the last few days, and I went down Exeter Road. I did that. I saw that they were out hot topping or something.
Oh,
coal patching. And doing that. And I think that was Lesard's crew. It wasn't town. It was a private company with, I think it was Lesard's crew was helping them.
They may have been patching a trench that they had done.
Yeah. Okay.
Oh. Yeah.
And then
because the town has been out there.
But another thing I noticed on Lock Road, especially
private trench,
where somebody has dug a trench across the road.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And I've noticed that those trenches that have been dug after the road was originally built are falling apart. Now, do we have any policy about that?
Yes.
We don't dig the road for a period of 5 years once it's been paved.
Okay.
Okay.
That's new, right?
When you put a trench across the street, you put up a bond.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And you have to guarantee the maintenance of that trench, I think it's for a year.
Mm-hmm. That's it?
That's it.
Right.
The problem you've got is once you break the pavement.
Correct. Yeah.
Okay. You now have two beautiful slots running right down either side of that break.
Yeah.
Where water is going to get in is going to heave that entire break eventually.
Right. So what do we do about, say I dig across Lock Road. I use that because that's the one that's severely damaged with these trenches.
Yeah.
There's a couple other potholes too, but the trenches are the problem. do everything in place, that if I dig a trench across there today, shouldn't that be guaranteed for the life of the road or something like that?
No, you can't. Nobody will guarantee it for that.
Yeah,
no
can.
One.
How about bonding until...
Asphalt lasts, on a complete application overlay, mm-hmm. at the maximum 15 years before it's replaced.
Yeah.
But
well,
when you're doing a patch, you're mixing two types of asphalt together. You've got the original asphalt overlay, which was overlaid with a machine, compacted and compressed, and then rolled.
Yeah.
You're not doing that with a trench patch. You're doing something completely different. There are other processes that you can use to patch a trench, which are enormously expensive.
Mm.
You end up heating the entire road and making one homogeneous mass out of it.
Well, the reason why I'm asking this is because I lived on Moss Road for years. The road was always pretty nice. Mm-hmm. Not a problem that I can recall living on Lock Road. Okay, this year, in particular, every seam that should have been tarred, and it wasn't, is got a frosty. Every trench on that street is coming apart, just about. And then at the bend about where you live, it's a mess. The whole road's coming apart
It's not just Lock Road. All over town.
It's all over
dreadful,
town.
Dreadful mess.
Right.
Dreadful mess.
So there's nothing we can do about trenches that were built, dug by Mike Pierce 10 years ago. The town is going to bite the bullet on.
We end up maintaining those.
Okay.
Yeah. Unfortunately, but we do.
Maybe we ought to have them paid some kind of a fee to dig a trench. So
once you crack open the road, Mike, you weaken the whole thing.
I'm not arguing with you, Mary Lee, but I want to finish my point.
No.
If the builder or whoever digs the trench, puts in a patch that's suitable, and it falls apart, say, 3 years down the road, I don't think the town should have to come along and fix that, because we already paid for the road once.
I understand that, but that's not the way the system works. Mm. You're going to get, at the maximum, 2 years hiatus on the trench.
Yeah.
Right.
Nice try.
So if we patch it, it's going to last about the same length of time, period.
That's true. Now, there are different types of patch you can use. For instance, in a pothole, I've suggested to Public Works that they go get some emulsified patch mix, okay?
Mm-hmm.
You throw the emulsified patch in there, and that water is just, you'll see it fly out of the hole. It'll disappear.
Mm-hmm.
It will not go back in. You may end up with a pothole beside it, but the original pothole is going to be filled.
Mm-hmm.
The problem is that material is extremely expensive compared to regular patch.
Okay.
So, if we're really going to fix these and make them stay for a while, as far as those potholes are concerned, you've got to use a better type material than what we're using.
Mm-hmm.
And it's much more expensive.
Mm. They'd have the town do the repair and bill the contractor for the...
Well, if the contractor is still under warranty,
depending
on how long a bond we have, we notify the contractor to go in and take the patch out and redo it.
Mm.
Now, there is another process you can use, and that is you can bring an infrared system in, and you can heat the road. The roadway is wide as this table. The patch is in the center like that.
Mm-hmm.
And you put a system out that's four times the size of the patch, and you homogeneously mash all that material together with heat.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so it all becomes bonded.
Yeah.
So you don't have that trench running across. You've got this huge area that's now bonded together.
Yeah.
That's extremely expensive as well.
Yeah.
None of these things are cheap.
Right.
Thank you,
Any
Mr.
other
Chairman.
Questions or comments for Fred?
No, thank you, Fred.
I got a couple. Just a point of information. When I saw the numbers on the January, February plowing or whatever.
That's just January.
Just January.
Yeah.
There was some, maybe it was in the paper. There's something I saw in February, too. I think Keith was quoted in the paper that went beyond January. Anyway, nonetheless, I just wanted to point out the winter maintenance budget, salt, overtime, sand, whatever, is almost exactly 3% of the DPW budget. Just a point of information or whatever.
Yep.
And it's roughly about 0.6% of our total $25 million-ish budget. So just point of information.
So let it snow.
Huh?
No.
Well, I'm glad we're way over as a percentage on 3% and not on 20%.
Right.
I guess that's the point. January financial report. I would say at this point we're into February 24th. It's not worth reviewing with Mike. I understand he's out until Thursday of this week, and I think that the approach that we should take is just in March review the combined January-February.
Mm-hmm.
But I would like to see at least copies of the January financial report available to the selectmen as soon as possible.
He is scheduled to come in and meet with you next Monday night, and I'm assuming he's going to have all that material in your mailboxes on Friday.
Okay. My only point is obviously Mike's been on vacation. He's busy.
Yeah.
January is 1 month. If that's the only reason
that
he's coming in,
yeah.
It would not bother me if it were deferred. Mm-hmm. So that's up to you.
Okay. All right. We'll take a look at what he's got.
Okay.
But you will get the report.
Yep. I was more interested in seeing the report as opposed to him having come in where he's trying to catch up.
And you are correct. There was a thing in the paper where we're over 80% of the budget expense.
Right, including because it had Keith quoted as through such and such a date in February or whatever.
We may have to sell about 15 of those 19 pickup trucks to pay the bills.
Okay.
I'm thinking about it.
MOU with State of New Hampshire. I asked about that in the middle of January. Has there been any activity or communication on that, Fred?
I've called them twice. I haven't received a response back.
Let me tell you what my concern is. I'm just going to give you my opinion. It wouldn't bother me one whole heck of a lot if we ended up with an agreement which was essentially the same as what we had last year, with one exception. Okay. You may recall last year on July 15th, we increased the rate that we charged the state from 4 cents to 7 cents.
Right.
Okay. Subsequent to that, we received a letter from the Attorney General, August 30th, 2013, disputing that or whatever.
Right.
We're not too far away from starting again, April 1 or whatever. So I think at the very least we need to solidify that 7%, all it does is covers our costs, we're not being opportunistic or whatever, that seven cents
goes into the agreement.
We have an agreement on that seven cents is the rate for 2014.
Right. Yeah.
Talk about not being opportunistic when they're taking us to the cleaner.
Well,
I
My point is we need to. They disputed the language. I don't know if they're right or wrong in their dispute, but we need to get the 2014 one agreed with language that assures that we're covering our costs at 7 cents.
We did subsequently revote that, taking into consideration their comments.
Yep. Yeah.
And they have been paying the 7 cents without a problem. So our intention was to work it into the agreement.
Yeah.
There's also a warrant article on the. On the ballot for this year that would affect the agreement because of the material, the rakings off the beach.
Oh, okay.
That is on the warrant article, so I've told them if that passes, then we'd have to modify that as well.
We better not see any more of that
The language, Mark, I don't know if you recall this, but one of the basis of their dispute was that there was language in the MOU that described it as the quote-unquote going rate, which there really isn't
a
going rate, okay? So I'm just suggesting that we enter into an agreement with them for this year that clarifies that, whether it says 7 cents, whether it says at cost as determined by the Board of Selectmen, or, you know, whatever, so that, and we're basically, it's not small money. We're doing roughly about 155 tons a year. A dred is doing about 155 tons a year with us, so the difference between 4 cents and 7 cents is close to $10,000.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So it's nothing to just, you know, ignore. So anyway, I wanted
Mr.
to bring that up.
Mr. Chairman, on that, once you haven't put in there whatever the cost is, then we won't have to change it when it goes up a penny or...
Well, and in fact, we were thinking of doing that simply because we need to annually review what those costs are. We take an escalator on our tipping fees every year.
Yeah,
we
sure.
wanted to make sure that we recalculate when we receive that tipping fee increase so that everybody's paying the same rate and the state isn't getting a break, nobody else getting a break. Everybody's paying the fair amount.
So that's what I'm suggesting in the document, though, rather than have it 7 cents, have it whatever the cost is. Something
at cost
no
as determined by the Board of Selectmen or as determined by the town manager or
DPW director. No, it's the Board of Selectmen.
Okay, let's move along.
Mayor, Mr. Chairman?
Sure.
Thank you. I wanted to speak about the sidewalk being plowed and cleaned by the state. And that's a significant event. And it didn't happen last year on a regular basis.
Right.
It didn't happen the year before. in the year before that.
I don't think it's ever happened.
And it's extraordinary. And could you, and I've got a follow-on, but how did this happen? Did you crack the whip? Are you the culprit?
We've been disagreeing with the state over that sidewalk now for several years, simply because we have a lot of folks who walk it constantly, okay? We almost lost a citizen last year walking in the street because the sidewalk wasn't cleared by the state. And yes, we made a big deal of that because the woman almost got run over and she reported it, and it was a dangerous situation. The state this year decided that they were going to do something. I don't know where they got the money for it because they said they didn't have any. But they did, they did get a piece of equipment. They took the piece of equipment down there and they removed all the snow. They blew it over the seawall onto the beach and cleaned it all off, so the sidewalk at North Beach was completely cleared off. And I think that's a grand thing to do. They should do it all the time.
My observation, they've actually done it twice. They didn't, the first time that I noticed it was only about 2 weeks ago, so it's not something that started
Sarah
right at the beginning
of
the season.
No,
they're actually doing, and I'm pretty sure of this, I'm not 100%, but they're actually doing, I believe, from Haverhill all of the way to High Street, okay?
Right.
One area they're not doing because it's town sidewalk or whatever is Boar's Head, in other words, from my road to Dumas or whatever. I did send an email to the state because I was curious, you know, like you, where did this come from or whatever, and the perception that I got from the response is it's something they're giving it a shot this year, they'll evaluate it, and hopefully they continue to do it in future years.
But whatever the genesis and whoever forged that cooperation, kudos. And great stuff. It's a bobcat. It's got a blower. Throws it right over the side, and it's great. And many, many people want to recreate down there. And moving along those lines, we talk about the appearance of the beach, and small things make a difference. And you heard Mr. Windmiller speak about the revenue that is created within 03842 and at the beach, and it's huge. It's a huge part of this state's success. And when we cinch that knot up a little more, now we have progress on the sidewalk, and now we look at these parking lots that are in the state, and we've of course studied the state parks income statements. We've looked at their balance sheets, and we know that they peel off $1 million from Hampton, and it gets swept, and it goes up to Concord.
Yeah.
We've looked at those financial statements, and there's $1 million.
Yeah.
And on an accrual basis, what they're not doing, of course, is accounting for that revenue and keeping those parking lots clean. And Mr. Lally was in tonight with many other fine business owners. He's a man that works for a living, like a lot of us do. And he's at his store every single day, and he's counting on a clean parking lot. And he spoke this week of a young woman, a single woman, that has a business. And, of course, this is her job, and she performs a service with musical instruments. And she has to leave to go to people's houses.
Yeah.
And she can't get her car out of the parking lot. And she can't work. And so here we have a case where we are moving forward with the sidewalks. We have that parking lot down there that is generating $1 million, and they leave, of course, they cover their expenses. They do $200,000 for a capital improvement fund to fund our seawalls, and the $1 million goes elsewhere. And I think that they don't need to plow the whole sidewalk. They need to make sure one side of that sidewalk is plowed. And of course, it should be up on the boulevard so people can get closer to their cars. It's a couple of passes with the big plow. It can be done, it can be scheduled, and as a way forward, I would recommend that we compliment the state on what they've done on the sidewalk. Get the Hampton Beach Village District Commissioners, get some of our legislators, get with this MOU, and incorporate that into our vision for what is soon to be next year. And I would like to see that plowed for a couple of sweeps. Mike, you know this capability. Yeah. That's not a lot to ask.
No.
It's a short strip. And that goes for both down past the bathhouse and on the north side of that, and in between those railroad ties, that center parking lot. What would you say to that?
Well, they weren't plowing the lower parking lot down where the Shell is. Okay, they are now.
Right.
They're doing that on a regular basis every storm at this point. They were not doing that before. So that's a big improvement. we've asked them to plow the other parking lots because a lot of folks use those in the wintertime.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They indicated, when we first started talking about it, that they'd be happy to do that, but then they're going to put the pavement meters in operation all winter. We suggested that that probably would not be a very bright idea, because people are not going to be paying their money into those things, and you're going to get a lot of flack in Concord. So
right.
They're thinking about it, but they haven't gotten to the point yet where they think it's a good idea.
Oh.
And we need to continue to bang away at it so that they will think it's a good idea.
My observation, last year I believe they were only plowing from like Haverhill to the Shell.
Right.
And when I say, I can't tell you for sure if it's every single storm, there's been so many. But my observation is they appear to be plowing mm-hmm. most of the time or all the time from the Shell up to the bathhouse by Mrs. Mitchell's or whatever.
Yeah.
And I think what you're also saying, but I don't think it's the state, is a lot of the parking lots being cleared north of the Ashworth, but I think that's just private people.
Mm-hmm. That's the construction going on up there. They've been clearing up, parking their own vehicles.
Well, okay. When you get further north by Rodden's Beach House or wherever it is,
yes.
That was not plowed.
No.
At all, because I thought, well, I'm too cheap to pay for the valet, so I'll park in there. I almost got stuck. It was probably a foot deep in there.
Yeah, it's pretty deep.
I think stuff that is plowed is private. Like people that I think like people that own hotels or have apartments or whatever.
Didn't the state used to plow that though?
No.
Never?
No. Not as long as I've lived there.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, before we get too maudlin and sentimental with all this wonderful stuff, I hope that the state takes the same effort when spring comes to sweep the sidewalks and clean up the roads from all the pebbles and rocks and detritus that was there as late as Memorial Day, because I drove down 1A all the way down the beach, and that was full of rocks where people can trip. And my daughter tells me that people were actually kicking the rocks out into the road to try to get them off the sidewalk.
Yeah.
That's a good way for people to twist their ankles and fall on their heads. So maybe they will carry the same enthusiasm forward into the spring.
Well, looking forward to it.
Yeah.
In ULI, I have a couple other items. Fred, you sent the selectmen, I assume it went to everybody, a memo related to trash pickup at 24 Acadia
mm-hmm.
Avenue.
Yes, mm-hmm. yes,
and
it did.
Actually, just an aside, I believe it's 50 Acadia. I went to the assessor's database and I couldn't find a 24 Acadia, and there is, just, you know, mm-hmm. what it's worth, there is. On the CAI system, there is a 50 Acadia.
Yeah.
So it looks
exactly. It's identified on the other records as number 24.
Maybe originally. But at any rate, if the assessor's database is 50.
Right.
I think the question is, okay, we have this memo.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very similar situation to Rubens Driftway and Ice House Lane. I don't see a distinction
difference
between the two. First question I have, I mean, people are, you know, and you also got a letter that somebody was unhappy with this one here or whatever.
Right.
First question, and maybe this is either directed to you or Mark, I mean, did the selectmen even have the authority to reverse the conditions of a planning board approval on stuff like this, snow plowing and trash and whatever?
Well, actually, I'm not sure back in the day, before my time, whether there was any involvement of the planning board in the condominium document process at all.
Right.
So that I'm not sure that the condition that appears in the condominium documents was imposed by the planning board
mm-hmm.
to begin with. But I think you always have authority over trash.
Okay. So there is, this I assume, what you've highlighted here on this 24 Acadia,
yes.
there is a condition of approval.
That's correct.
At the time, 2002, whatever it was in this particular case.
And see, I don't think the planning board has the authority to impose something over your authority in the first place about trash.
That's why I have asked for a statement from this board for me to communicate to the planning board as to our wishes regarding waste.
Okay. My comment on this 24, which I believe is 50, Acadia, I don't see any rationale for taking any different approach on that than we did on Ice House Lane and Rubens.
Consistency is the key.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So do we have a consensus on that? Or
I say you have to be consistent. You can't be favoring one group over another one.
Okay.
Well, what you did with those other situations is I think you set a date by which
correct.
To inform people where whatever you've had before, you're not going to have again.
Right, and I think that's what
I didn't know if you wanted to set a time for that so the manager would have some...
What we did is we contacted them and we worked out a time.
Okay.
And it worked out better that way. Some people are very upset. There always will be people who are upset.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it's not here in the memo. So you've actually been in touch with...
Not yet.
Okay.
We sent this to you first.
Right, okay.
So
but I think what you're getting is you're getting a consensus that we should go
ahead
and talk
to them.
Consistent.
Yep. Okay.
Yep.
Final thing, I've got kind of minor thing, but again, I assume everybody got it. It was a couple of pages from the New Hampshire Employment Security in our boxes. Did everybody see this and whatever?
Yeah.
And just, I'll give you this copy. I've highlighted a few things, but there's quite a few what appear to me to be errors that I think are worth pointing out back to them so that their website
has... We do every year.
...accurate.
Yeah.
But, I mean, for example, and Paul took care of this one, but it's got our email address as inquiries at Town Hampton, New Hampshire, U.S., and inquiries is spelled wrong.
Oh.
So I suspect if somebody types it in that way, it's probably not going to work. Correct, Paul?
It'll work, yeah.
Okay, so you've got both the proper spelling and the inaccurate spelling. And apparently that goes to Christina or whatever when that's sent in. That's one. I can't make any sense out of this. It's showing school appropriations of $41,908,000. That's not possible. I mean, we've only got total appropriations of $50 million, including the town and the schools. The town are about a net 20.
They're including Winneconnet.
Huh?
They're including Winneconnet.
But that's not the Hampton share of Winneconnet.
I think they're including the whole of Winneconnet.
Right. Anyway, I don't think it serves us to have gross inaccuracies that. And
Richard, in Concord, anything is possible.
Well, at any rate, I think we ought to point out the things that we know are on. The final one is the population figure for 2010 is wrong, and it's still, you remember how the first pass with Portsmouth
that
in there, and it's significant. It's 400 or 500
difference
high.
Yeah.
So at any rate, you can have
Thank
that.
Thank you.
Wow. Old business.
Okay, old business. IT policy related to monitoring and intercepting of information. And this was discussed briefly at the last meeting, and I'll provide the background information on why I placed this on the agenda. There are philosophical and ethical issues. Those being, what is the increased security? When is increased security worth reduced privacy? It's philosophical, it's ethical, it's not just a legal issue or whatever. Second one is, are people entitled to any privacy where messages communicated and stored on town email system is concerned? Are people entitled to any privacy? That, again, is a philosophical and an ethical issue. The current policy is pretty clear that employees have no right of privacy, and I'll read the two sentences that I was concerned about. The town manager or his designee reserves the right to monitor, review, audit, intercept, access, and disclose all messages sent and received, except for confidential information under state and federal law. There is no right of privacy in material generated and stored in the town's computer equipment. So I think our policy as it stands today is pretty clear that there is no right of privacy. I'll rely on the town attorney for an opinion on the legal aspects or whatever. I have no reason to believe that this whole thing isn't completely legal.
Right.
I'm not challenging that. However, on a philosophical level, personally, I believe people are entitled to some privacy. It's my personal feeling. In the case of email messages, the implications are broader than just employee privacy. Email communication can and does involve members of the public sending and receiving messages to town employees. Thus, this policy affects the privacy of the public. We're probably not aware of the town's information technology use policy and have not signed anything in terms of agreeing to its terms. I understand the need to manage our network and to keep our system secure. Things like controls on internet access, prohibiting the installation of personal software on town computer systems are absolutely acceptable measures. But the town is not a private entity with a need to protect trade secrets and other proprietary information. I just don't see the justification for policy of allowing email content monitoring without cause. Okay, and that's the key in my concern, whether or not there's some level of cause. The policy does not indicate that there has to be a cause.
I would seek to address this concern by asking the town attorney to craft language that assures that this aspect of the IT policy is legal, okay, of course, and place some limitations on what appears to be too open-ended. Perhaps something as simple as, with just cause as determined by the town manager and town attorney or HR coordinator or whatever, I would find completely satisfactory. My reference to the NSA a couple of weeks ago was just that what NSA is doing is just totally open-ended. They're capturing phone calls and emails essentially from everyone, not just people who they have some reason to believe that there's some sort of risk of terrorism or whatever other reasons. So I think anything else in terms of my proposal, anything else that the town attorney and Paul came up with language that accomplishes that, I'm not hung up on what the exact language is. I would feel much more comfortable in terms of my point on the some privacy is if there was something in there that said just cause as determined by, again, town manager and town attorney or town manager and HR coordinator, whatever. The only other thing I would add, and I'm done, is that given this policy has not been updated in 14 years, town staff may want to take a broader look at it than the singular issue I've raised, but I saw nothing else in there other than these two sentences that I highlighted that are a particular concern for me. So that's my take. I don't know, Fred, if you want to comment, or Paul, or Mark,
well,
or whatever.
If you read the paper about the issues with regards to Seabrook and the county attorney, they were doing some things in the police department that were, in my opinion, violated the eavesdropping and wiretap law. Mm. And I don't want to go there without some clear designation that, in fact, someone has violated the law. I'm not going to go look at personal email. Ain't going to happen. Just is not going to happen. That, I think, is prohibited to some degree by the statute dealing with wiretapping. And it talks about communications of this nature. So I, having already been with a county attorney in another town, who found that the police department was in fact doing something wrong in violation of the wiretap law, mm-hmm. I don't wish to revisit that in this town or have anybody else revisit in this town. I think that's important. I think you need to have just cause regardless of what happens, and if you don't have just cause, then maybe you've committed a crime. I'm just simply not going to go there.
Sounds like you're agreeing with me, Fred. Is that the case, or?
I think more or less, yes. I think that there is a state law that prohibits that type of access without just cause.
I assume you're referring to RSA 578:2. It's titled Interception and Disclosure of Telecommunications or Oral Communications Prohibited.
Right.
Just for what it's worth, that statute has been amended 7 times since our IT policy was enacted back in July of 2000. So I don't know if there are any issues there. The other thing that I'll tell you, I was in this field for a number of years, and I kind of get intrigued on it, so I drilled down more than I otherwise would. But it's a, there's all kinds of shades of gray in this, because one thing with oral communications, I think, is very clear, is what you can and can't do. Telecommunications becomes very gray, because you then get in the area as to whether or not email is telecommunications, some of the decisions by the FCC relative to whether or not broadband internet service providers represent a common carrier and so on and so forth. But at any rate, I would be completely happy if we just added something to those sentences that just require that there be some cause and who's going to determine that. Mary Louise?
I think for cause is too vague. I think that material coming from outside the town office, outside the departments, is something you can't control. If a neighbor sends me an email, they can say whatever they say. I shouldn't be blamed for that. On the other hand, we're not a private business. We're a public business. And we own the the communications media, and I think we have a responsibility, and it doesn't say shall, it says may in here, which the town may examine at any time. I wouldn't expect the town manager or anyone else to be prowling the halls, peering at people's computers. However, if an employee should say, gee whiz, I think Joe Blow is playing poker on his computer system or whatever, I would think that an opening like that, the certain town manager certainly doesn't have the time to sit down and fiddle through everybody's computer, but if you get tips, hints, or if someone from the outside is saying, gee whiz, hey, Mr. Manager for the town of Hampton, we think somebody's pulling monkey business on your computer, I think we have every right to go in and take a look. And it is May.
When there's just cause.
But what is just cause?
Just cause is something
It's vague.
Can I continue?
It's vague.
Okay, I'll answer your question, my take, and certainly Paul, Fred, or Mark can comment. We have a list in other locations of the policy of inappropriate use. Mm-hmm. Okay, so just cause is simply, in my estimation, it's some indication that there is some level of inappropriate use based on, and if you look at the listings of inappropriate use, it lists a whole host a whole host of examples, but then it also goes on to say this list is not all inclusive or whatever.
Right.
So I'm very comfortable with the, you know, some combination, town manager, town attorney, like I said, making that determination. And to your point, Mary Louise, it does not say may. Okay.
It does right here, which the town may examine. I'm reading it in English, right in the black print that you're complaining about. Which the town may examine at any time. It doesn't say shall. It says may. That's the discretion. That's why we're paying department heads. That's why we're paying an attorney.
What I am suggesting is that part of that criteria in the policy, I'm not talking about what's being done and what's not being done. My indication is that it's not being done. We're strictly talking about what the policy allows, okay? And the policy allows that and does not mention just cause. So I would, rather than beat the thing to death, I will make a motion and
can
it goes forward.
Can I enter something in before you get into the motion mode first? Because I haven't had a chance. I've been listening to you two yak for a while. No offense, okay? My problem is this. I work for a company, and their policy was almost a duplicate of this. That's the way most companies were back when I was working.
Yeah.
No problem with any of that. That's the way it was. You didn't like it, leave the company, okay? Now, back to this. I have a big problem with disclose all messages. If I send an email and somebody thinks it's inappropriate and then they decide to disclose it to whom, okay? To the public, okay? That word disclose should be removed.
Where are you, Mike?
I'm right in the bold, right? You're
on
babbling the about the
oh,
main.
Oh, access
okay?
and disclose.
Third line up.
Yeah, gotcha.
Okay, I've got more problems, too, with this. It says the town manager or his designee.
Mm-hmm.
Not saying Fred would do it, but Fred could say that the guy that rakes my yard can do it. Doesn't say who. It doesn't say who. It's a designee, and he can pick anybody he wants by this rule. Okay, and that means he could pick somebody from Oshkosh. I don't want anybody from Oshkosh to look at my email, number one. So I think that designee ought to be removed.
Okay.
Let me tell you the two instances where we have had to take action in the computer system by policy. Okay?
Okay.
We were told that an individual, I won't say who, but an individual, an elected individual, mm-hmm. brought a relative in and put programs into our computer system.
Oh, that's not good.
Okay? And I asked Paul to check that. We did check it, and we found that it was true, and we had those programs removed. I then asked Paul to check and to see, because I noticed as I was walking around the building one day, I noticed people sitting there playing poker and playing solitaire and so on and so forth, which is not what we're here to do. So I asked Paul to check on that, and all the computer systems, in fact, they come with these programs in them.
They do.
So we had them all taken out. And then periodically I've asked him to go and look and see whether somebody hasn't installed one again. And if they have, we take it out. those are the only two interactions that we have had
yeah.
in the computer system as far as the policy is concerned.
That's a couple of comments.
You've got to watch the selected official.
First of all, I have no issue whatsoever with that, and what was done with cause, but I'm not even addressing that. The only point that I'm raising is the right to monitor, review, audit, intercept, access, right. and disclose the content. It doesn't say the content. Email messages. That's all I'm talking about. I'm not talking about whether or not somebody, is removing games that somebody's installed on the systems. That's not the issue I'm raising, and
no.
I don't have a problem with that. And that's part of the rest of the policy that I said. It all looks fine and makes sense. The concern that I've got is very narrow
yep.
within the scope of the whole policy. That has to do with a policy that provides the right to do these things, monitor, review, audit, intercept, access, and disclose email messages sent and received, and doesn't have any mention of cause. So I would simply make the motion, and I would give the town attorney, Paul, all kinds of latitude to where you go with it, so just more or less to get the spirit of what I'm after, that simply as language that's something in effect as simple as with just cause as determined by the town manager and town attorney or town manager and HR coordinator or whatever.
I'd like to see the designee and
can we get a second on that, and then just so we can kind of get through this, we can have more discussion.
Can't we just amend the motion?
Is there a second on the motion?
Let's get a second.
Is there a second?
I'll second the motion for it because
okay.
I want to make an amendment to it. Okay. I want to add, let's take a look while you're looking at that issue by removing his designee. Okay. And also look at the disclose. Disclose can be published in the Hampton Union, for example.
Mike, what was the first thing that you said?
Designee. The manager or his designee.
Okay.
Okay. I have no problem with the town manager, or you can even include somebody else there with the town manager, like the town attorney or whoever you want, but I don't think we should just have the designee because that's very ambiguous.
Okay. So you've made you're essentially making a motion, we've got a second.
Yeah.
You're basically making a motion to make an amendment.
Yeah. To drop the word his designee. And also to drop the word disclose.
Okay, do we have a second to the motion to amend? I'm not going to, we don't appear to, okay? I'm not going to make a second to amend that, but I'd like to explain why. Is I believe that the way it's written, that it gives the town manager the latitude to determine who that designee is, and I'm fine with Fred, you know, making that determination. I think it also gives the town manager the authority to determine if and what entity to disclose it to. And I'm perfectly happy that he has that level of authority to make good judgments as to who the designee is and to who he does or does disclose it. So I don't feel a need to amend it in that way. Mary Louise?
I'm not saying this to be disrespectful. It's irrelevant about Fred. You're talking about a town manager.
Right. Yeah.
This is
right.
generic.
Right, right.
Yeah. This should apply to anyone in
Absolutely.
That position.
Absolutely.
Right?
Exactly.
So you're writing this for the future
yes.
and for
Absolutely.
Implementation.
That's why I think the amendment should
there.
Apply, yes.
May we move on and do something here?
Yep, I would like to move to a vote.
Before you do that. You had asked me earlier in the day to check on the applicability or not of RSA 578
okay,
having to deal with wiretapping and eavesdropping.
Yep.
It prohibits and actually says you're guilty of a Class B felony if you endeavor to intercept a telecommunication or oral communication. Intercept is very broadly defined. And also, it's not just the simultaneous
right.
interception, it's the after-the-fact interception
okay.
comes into play.
You drive the state through it.
Right. And so telecommunication is also very broadly defined.
Yeah.
It's the transfer of any form of information in whole or in part through the facilities of a communications common carrier. And I'm not sure whether or not every email carrier is a common carrier. Paul once educated me several years ago as to why it took a little longer for our scanning of information at the manager's copier to my 30 feet away computer terminal, and I found out it was routed through Albany, New York. And so it traveled pretty fast, but it went a long way. And I'm not sure that that system is considered a common carrier. So all that's by way of saying to you that I think perhaps it's a little more complicated than just cause. I may want to add a whole bunch of words.
I absolutely, Mark, and if you recall, one of the things I said before I even said to the just cause, I said that this aspect of the IT policy is legal. And you are absolutely correct, and my take just from what I read, you're going to spend a little bit of time getting to the bottom of that whole common carrier thing to make sure that it is legal. Mary Louise?
I have a question for Mark. That refers to what? Does that refer to everything? Does that refer to private businesses? Does that refer to municipalities? What's the point of reference in there? It's just generic?
I looked for that very thing, and it seemed very broad. It didn't confine it to private business, public business.
Is intercept the key here?
No.
Because what I'm trying to get at is, if there have been a series of email communications that are in some fashion illicit or improper.
Whether they're illicit or not. It's got nothing to do with whether they're illicit.
Well,
it's the ability to monitor.
Well,
you want to look at this stuff for a reason. And if you're doing it while the communication is ongoing, there may be a problem. What about if you catch up with it 2 months later or a year later, or somebody says, hey, Joe was doing something or other?
Well, when it says something is illegal to do, then you want to know, well, how can you do it legally?
Right.
And so you look further in the chapter, and it talks about an application for an order to a judge.
Oh, okay.
Which is beyond Fred and beyond me.
So if the manager had a big problem, he could theoretically go to you and say, we need to petition the court to look at this.
Yes, and the AG's office comes
into play,
too.
That shouldn't be an impediment. It might be a little extra work, but if there's something really problem,
we could spend all night. I think it's pretty clear that Mark's got a little bit of work to do to assure that it is, in fact, legal. Can we take this to a vote now?
I had a couple of comments. I haven't been able to speak yet, and I would just, I don't know the genesis of this, and I know our IT is in good hands with Paul. I know we have a chief of police, we have law enforcement. We've heard about statutory protections for employees. Our employees are honest. Our employees are dutiful. They're task-oriented. They're professional. And our leadership is certainly half as good as that. And I didn't know that this was an issue. I don't know where it came from, Mr. Chairman, and respecting that and respecting your interest in it. And I will say that this is a municipal platform that provides first responder services. And if somebody is in law enforcement and someone needs to access their email for an investigation and suddenly they're not around, if there's a fire incident and a first responder needs communication data, and this transcends over into their telephones. And I think we're going the wrong way on this. I think we need to be more open. I've got a couple of thousand, 3,000 emails. Mark could scrub the ones that relate to personnel or real private issues that I would grant the town attorney to look at. And then I'd be happy to release all of my emails.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
All of them. I mean, I work for the taxpayers.
Same here.
I work for the voters. And that this platform, this is my computer, but for my email account for the town of Hampton, it's free game. And I would say everything just about that I've said in non-public, I would say it in public. Mm-hmm. Came to that. And I think we have too much privacy. We don't have a metric where information that once was private and germane to the privacy issue, where it is released, where it is no longer. We never do that. and word filters out. So I respect that, but I take the standard that our employees are honest, hardworking, that they would never abuse the practice of this, and that would require someone to spy on their emails unnecessarily. And if they do, that's a crime. And if it's a repeated thing, and anyone that's doing that, then they're the ones that need to move on. And I think that we have an IT guy here. I don't know how this stuff works. And there can be metrics that are established for who's looking at other people's emails, and these little whiz-bangers can figure it out, and they can tell you, and you can get a report, who's looking at what, and protect identities. But I think everybody needs to know this is Town of Hampton property. These are Town of Hampton computers. You work for the Town of Hampton, and then we need more openness and less drill down on who can look at what. And again, this is a platform of first responders, and it could be life and death. And if people are worried about going and looking at someone else's email, happens in my business all the time. I jump on one of my partners' emails, do the search, came from this person, I don't know, and you're looking on their computer. Find out what's going on for your customers. Yeah. And I think we need that kind of flexibility. I can talk about it all night. We did request to push this back. I have not yet seen a final chop from the town attorney, from Paul, on an ordinance or an improvement. And I think it needs to come from legal, and it needs to come to IT, to us, and then perhaps us massaging it. I think we got it the other way around. Thank you, Mr. Chen.
Okay, any further discussion?
Can you repeat the motion again? I've forgotten what it was. Sorry.
The motion is to assure that this aspect, again, the two sentences that are highlighted in bold, of the IT policy is legal, okay, and place some limitations on what appears to be too open-ended. And again, it was the spirit of what I'm saying as opposed to the exact language that we would expect Paul and Mark to run with, that it could be as simple as simply adding that there is just cause as determined by the town manager and town attorney or HR coordinator, whatever, some combination.
And it was like, and you were asking the attorney to look into all this stuff and report back to us with your motion.
With essentially a proposal that amends it, and what we end up with is something that we know is legal.
And okay, thank you. That's all I wanted to know.
All in favor?
Yeah.
Opposed? Motion passes 3-2 with Bean and Woolsey opposed. The reality is no actual change or action will be taken until Mark and Paul come back to us with some language.
Before these gentlemen leave, may I ask something of Paul?
Sure.
I was trying to find the contracts online a week or so ago, and was told by Christina, God bless her, that they're under human resources, which is not where I expect to see contracts. And I did ask Paul when I walked in the building, and something he said made me think. And I will say that I agree with you, and I respect your bringing it up to me, Paul. He said people are bugging him all the time to do this, do that, or whatever with the system. I think, in fairness to him, that any and all requests from anybody should be funneled through Fred. Any and all requests
have
anything
done. I agree
with that, Mrs.
Woolsey, 100%.
Yes.
That a motion?
Yes. So that he's not going crazy. And I just started out trying to find where the silly contracts were located, and it turned. But I really appreciated his comments.
So you're
yes,
saying that
I
if you wanted to, let me understand.
Yeah.
If you want to understand where the contracts are, you would not ask Paul. You would ask Fred.
No. If I want the contracts located under documents where I think they should be, because I go looking for them under documents and they're under human resources, which I think is absolutely silly, or put them in both places. But I shouldn't be the one to say that. I should be able to bring it up to Fred or to the board and say, you know, help. Can we do this? And let him judge and work with Paul, because I don't think people should be making individual requests.
I don't have a problem with that, but I will tell you, for example, the way that kind of thing has gone down in the past, and I've had quite a bit of it because of the CBA negotiations or whatever, but
for example, when we reach the point that all the CBA tentative agreements have been ratified by the unions and the board, I actually went to Wanda as opposed to Paul, and I said, geez, we should get them up on the website somewhere so the public has access to it. If you're suggesting, you know, in the future that I should go to Fred as opposed to going to Wanda the way I did that, I really don't have a problem
with
that.
Well, it's not a matter
you can do it by email. I mean, and the other thing that I would mention as well is there's also an issue of having some judgment as to whether or not what you're asking is a 30-second transaction or whether it's a half hour. I just don't think that it's appropriate for me to be, or anybody, going to Fred for something that's a 30-second or a 1-minute thing that,
okay, it's
by the time it winds its way to Paul, may get kind of lost in the, you know, the translation. Paul always has the right. Paul always has the right when something's time-consuming, whatever that means, and I don't care if it's 10 minutes or 15 minutes if you're busy, to say, hey, can you send that request to Fred?
Yep.
And whatever, and I'm absolutely fine with that, too. But I just would hate to have too much
okay, what I'm trying to put out, we heard you say put the contracts online. So I said, okay, so I'm looking for the contracts online.
They're not
I
online.
Can't find the
contracts. They're not online. The tentative agreements are online.
But you said the contracts would be online. And that,
the tentative
I'm sorry, I'm taking you literally. Smile at me for a minute.
Okay, I'll smile.
And the fact finder's report for the fire department is online.
Right.
That does not constitute the entire contract. I'm looking for the contracts that we're going to be voting on. I'm not done yet.
Okay.
And then...
Sounds like me talking to you.
Well, tough tomatoes. I'm looking for the contracts online, and I expect to see the current contracts online because we have an issue coming up, and I was trying to review the contract, which is what got me going on this whole thing in the first place. Having the contracts online is one thing. Where are they is the other thing. And I say contracts belong under documents like agendas and minutes and all that stuff so I can find the confounded things. All I'm trying to figure out is to get this. If you want them under human resources, fine. If you want them under recreation, I don't care. But I'm looking for some logical sequence here or some logical placement. And I shouldn't have to bug Paul about it.
Okay.
I'd like to help you out.
Thank you.
I think your request should definitely go through Fred because, from what I understand, via the rumor mill, there's one person on this board that is down there bugging him all the time. And it's not me.
Well, it's not me either.
I don't think it's me.
I never talked to Fred.
Oh. No, he's talking about Paul.
No, but I don't generally bug.
Let me respond.
But I just want to find the contracts.
Okay. First of all, the contracts, to the best of my knowledge, are nowhere on the town website.
That's my problem.
That's why you're not finding them.
Yes.
Okay. The tentative agreements and the fact finder's report are on the town website.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, and then I put the links to the state of New Hampshire.
Exactly.
The old
that,
stuff,
that's,
and I found
that's
those
where,
links
that's where
and put
I was
those
headed.
Up.
The contracts are on the PELRB website. All
and,
of the contracts.
And they're linked off
How
of
am
our
I supposed
website.
To know that?
Yes, Paul.
Ask me if you don't want to borrow a ball.
The biggest problem was that morning I was knee-deep into something
else. No, I know that. Bless your heart. I understand that. But I'm a member of the public, and I just want to read the contracts. A, I wanted to read the existing contract.
Okay.
My suggestion is there's no room on the internet, but my suggestion in the future...
When you want to know something like that that relates to the personnel policy, contracts, tentative agreements, see Wanda.
But don't sit there telling me that the contracts are online and on the internet because they're not.
I would never do that intentionally,
you did.
Mary.
You said the contracts are online.
I said intentionally. I would never, if I said that, I misspoke.
Did he not say the contracts are online?
He's going to remember that. Okay. Moving along.
Yeah. Sometime today.
Other old business.
Yes, I do have a request. Old business, Mr. Chairman. I was, when we went down to the grand opening of the fire station, the beach, and we went to the grand opening of the Winnicott fire station, there's one thing that's missing in both places. There's no plaque honoring.
They're working on it.
A plaque honoring the fire chief, Chris Silva, should be right at the top in big letters.
Yeah.
he did a beautiful job on both projects.
Yes.
When it comes to all the rest of the rubbish below, that can be in small print or not there at all, as far as I'm concerned. Chris Silver deserves all the credit for that beach fire station and whatever he did to the one uptown.
Yep.
Yep. I have already told him to do that.
He's going to put his name in big letters.
Well, he better.
He better. if it comes in here for approval, I won't approve it unless he's right up there.
Okay. Other old business.
Wait 1 second, too. Do you intend to do this year what you've done in years past as far as the selectmen reviewing the warrant articles before the meeting, before the vote?
I don't know if we did that last year.
I believe you did.
I think you did. It was the year before.
Well, you should in case it changed.
Well, there's no change, but it's just a refresher for individuals who care to watch. Mm-hmm. I just, you know,
what do you when would you suggest?
Saturday. I guess it would have to be a Saturday.
I think we've weighed in enough. I'm not high on
that. I'm not meeting on Saturday.
Huh?
I'm not meeting on Saturday.
Okay, well, yeah. I just bringing it up. If you,
I don't think we did it last year. I think we've weighed in on the warrant articles. I'm not.
Okay.
Okay.
What do you mean? It hasn't been done in years past.
What do you mean by Saturday?
Going to, well, what else?
You know, the meeting schedule for Saturday.
The world wouldn't end.
Yes, it
will.
I
don't care, but it has been done in years past. I just ask.
Okay, I don't think we need to. I think
it's
we've
not life or death.
Not recently.
Thank you.
Okay, any other old business?
Nope.
I just have one other item. And it's just I'll mention it and actually talk to the individual. I had a phone message this morning when I came back from walking the dog. Somebody complaining about inconvenience related to the road race on Sunday. That was the only complaint, and I'm just curious, did anybody else have any complaints?
I did. I've discussed it with the chief. All right.
I had one complaint, anyway. Okay, new business. Town of Hampton audits 2011 through 13. Phil had requested this be on the agenda.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. Appreciate it very much. This is definite put you to bed, put you to sleep time. If Ben Moore was here, he'd be grabbing a cigarette break. We talked about this a couple of years ago. Mm-hmm. It's about finance. I've shared it with Fred. We've talked about our audit reports. Mm-hmm. And what we do here is exciting. It is where the rubber meets the road. And specifically, there's a couple of things in terms of depreciation of our assets and conformance with government accounting standing boards, which is a nonprofit organization funded by some of the top accountants.
Yeah. GASB,
Dodd-Frank, they're funded by that and the Salem publications. Yeah. It's an extraordinary board of a mix of academics and public accountants, public service.
Yep.
That sets standards and opinions and guidelines, and we don't meet a couple of those, and it's been a long time since we haven't done that. And we've heard in the last couple of weeks from our fine paper, the Portsmouth Herald and the Seacoast Media Group, or the Hampton Union, and we're hearing and seeing front page articles about pensions soar over peers. We're seeing links to people that have, in conformance and in obeyance of state laws, earned retirement benefits and salaries, and those are publicized out there. And what we don't look at is the cost in the accounting. And we hear people from Concord or heads of labor groups talking about future retirees that will be on food stamps, and there are other unions in other periodicals that have come out with the same things. And in terms of our job, and at least as I see our role on the strategic issue, I think if we do comply more with GASB rules, and our auditors point these out, and we'll talk about the 2011 in just a moment, then we get into the core of the issue, we get into real fixed costs, and then we start to make headway. But right now, people publishing retirement salaries and talking about food stamps gets us absolutely nowhere. And, you know, it really is an extraordinary amount that state and local governments spend as a percentage of the GDP. And this is from the GASB website. And by any measure of size, state and local governments are a substantial portion of the U.S. economy. $2.4 trillion for financing and borrowings. $2.1 trillion for local and state governments for their revenue that was collected. For comparison purposes, state and local government expenditures represent 16.5% of the U.S. gross domestic product. And we're a small part of that, but it's important. Equally as important is there's 16.8 million employees on a full-time equivalent basis, or 11%, almost 12%, of the total population in this country. And when we have these kinds of headlines, when we have this type of hysteria, it doesn't get to the issue. Specifically, our 2011 audit, and again, this was brought up a couple of years ago, and I'm on the 2011, it says 2012 annual report.
Yes.
We're in the 2011 on page 125. Management, which would be us, the selectmen, has not recorded the capital assets and the government activities, accordingly has not recorded depreciation expense on those assets. Accounting principles generally accepted in the United States of America require that capital assets, this would be our fire stations that are millions of dollars,
mm-hmm.
our police station, our pump station, and the depreciation is an expense,
yeah.
especially as we try and fix expenses with the state.
Mm-hmm.
We're not recording those. And that's a significant expense. So if these were capitalized and depreciated, this would increase the assets, net assets, and the expenses of government. The amount by which this departure would affect the assets, net assets, and expenses of the governmental activities is not determinable in the town of Hampton. I don't think that's the standard that we really need to be at. It's costing the taxpayers money, and we don't get a true sight picture. So educated in Hampton Junior High, Winnicott High School, and the Whittemore School, and those aren't the standards that I was taught. Furthermore, and I'll go into these, as discussed in Note 16 to the financial statements, management has not recorded the long-term costs of retirement health care and obligation for other post-employment benefits and governmental activities in this town. Accounting principles generally accepted in the United States of America require that those costs be recorded, which would increase the liabilities and expenses of the governmental activities. The amount by which this departure would affect the liabilities, net assets, and expenses of the government activities is not reasonably determinable. So we don't know what these costs are. We're not using any accrual accounting or semi-accrual accounting, and it's a pig and a poke.
Mm-hmm.
And all we get is hysteria. The auditor continues, in our opinion, because of the effects of the matters discussed in the preceding two paragraphs, the government-wide financial statements referred to above do not present fairly in conformity with accounting principles generally accepted in the United States of America. The financial position of the governmental activities of the town of Hampton as of December 31st, 2011, or the changes in financial position thereof for the year ending. So that's a big disclaimer. And all they're really doing is going in and doing what we do when we talk to Mike. They're looking at fund balances, they're looking at
mm-hmm.
how money
yeah.
moved, but they're not talking about the balance sheet. They're not. All we're doing is we're skimming the dust looking at the income
yeah.
statement. Again, I want to bring back the issue of the fire department, two of them, fairly new police department, pump station. We are not recording that depreciation. It was an expense, which when we're looking for town data, we talk to the state about. So we go on, we look at the notes. GASB 34, the government-wide statement of net assets, does not include any of the town's capital assets nor accumulated depreciation on those assets. These amounts have not been determined. We're talking tens of millions of dollars. Tens of millions of dollars that are not in assets, and if you're depreciating them, we're not writing off that expense, and we can't charge for that expense. And it's going to take a couple of minutes, so hold fast.
No.
Now.
She's fighting it a bit.
Oh, yeah. Here we go. Now, specifically in the notes, the employee retirement plan. Now, that's a plan that's
mm-hmm.
written in law.
Yeah.
And men and women work under that, and it's
mm-hmm.
a law.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes when people write laws, they don't look at the cost. And we don't know the cost. And the accountants have just told us we don't know the cost.
Yeah.
And we're not fixing the cost, and we simply don't know the cost. But we have these promises, and we have friction. And it's not fair to our employees, and it's not fair to the taxpayers.
Yeah.
And I'm not satisfied that we're doing the due diligence as managers. And if people want to change, the retirement system, they can do so through the state legislature. It's a law, and they can do that. And that's what some of the press was this past couple of weeks. In addition to the pension benefits described in the preceding note, the town provides post-employment benefit options for the health care. These are in coordination with their collective bargaining agreements. It goes on and talks about GASB, Government Accounting Standing Boards 45, and I've got a couple of those to read to you very, very quickly. And it's important, and the elections are coming up soon, and this could be the same bunch of people in a month, or it could be a whole bunch of different people. And Mike Swalcher has done an outstanding job in this town as the finance director. And perhaps it's time for a new look going forward. And I will make no motions tonight, but wanted to raise this. And I think these are perfectly acceptable questions to ask if you folks that are running ask in a debate on what your position is on this. So 45 talks about accounting and financial reporting by employers for post-employment benefits other than pensions. And that's for health insurance and all the other benefits that are guaranteed. It says, this statement establishes the standards for the measurement, recognition, and display of OPEB, other than their retirement expenditures, related liabilities, assets, note disclosures, and if applicable, the required supplementary information. From an accrual accounting perspective, the cost of OPEB, like the cost of pension benefits, generally should be associated in periods within which the exchange occurs rather than with the periods when the benefits are paid out. We're talking about the accrual basis, and we're not doing it. However, in current practice, most OPEB plans are financed on a pay-as-you-go basis, and financial statements, like ours, do not report the financial effects until the promised benefits are paid. We've got benefits out there 20, 30, 40 years, yep. And we don't know what the costs are. We are not complying with GASB. As a result, current financial reporting generally fails to recognize the cost of the benefits in the periods when the related services are received by the employer. Continuing, it fails to provide information about the actuarial accrued liabilities for promised benefits associated with past services and whether and to what extent those benefits have been funded. Finally, it fails to provide information useful in assessing potential demands on the employer's future cash flow. That's the town of Hampton's future cash flow. And just as importantly, and more importantly, is men and women that are relying on these retirements. And they're making plans, and we're not adequately doing our job. The statement provides the relevance and usefulness of financial reporting by requiring a systematic accrual-based measurement and recognition of OPEB over a period that approximates the employee's years of service, providing information about the actuarial accrued liabilities. It goes on here and it gets into the details and talks about exactly how to do that. In our financial audit, our accounting audit, our balance sheet would look much, much different if we were complying with GASB, and we're not. And we don't know the costs, and we're not doing our job, and we need to change that, in my opinion, and in the opinion of the Government Accounting Standards Board. OPEB expenditures should be recognized on a modified accrual basis in governmental financial statements. Net OPEB obligations, if any, including amounts associated with, under, or over contributions from governmental funds, should be displayed as liabilities in government-wide financial statements. And we're getting none of that. Talking about the summaries, and again, these are our men and women and our taxpayers, and we're the management, and we're the people that GASB is talking to. This is accounting for pensions by state and local government employers. The annual pension cost should be equal to the employer's annual required contributions to the plan unless the employer has a net pension obligation for past over or under contributions. We don't have that. The ARC is defined as the employer's required contributions for the year, calculated within certain parameters. These parameters include requirements for the frequency and timing of actuarial variations. We do none of that. As well as for the actuarial methods and assumptions that are acceptable for financial reporting. An NPO is defined as the cumulative difference between the annual pension cost and the employer's contributions to a plan, including any pension liability or asset at transition. An employer with an NPO should measure the annual pension cost equal to the ARC, 1 year's interest on the NPO, and see an adjustment to their ARC to offset the actuarial amortization for past over or under. So it's a fluid process. It's locked in concrete. It's actuarial. And when I do it, and we talked about it a year ago. I called up the accounting firm, and I remember dialogue here, and I had informed Fred and Mike both that I was calling. Finally, I think it's a glaring deficiency in our leadership. Employers that participate are required to recognize pension expenditures and expense equal to the employer's contractually required contributions and a liability for unpaid contributions. Now, we all know the state stopped funding. There's a huge hole. In addition to descriptive information about the plan and its funding policy, the required disclosures includes 3 years of information about the employer's required contributions and the percentage contributed. So we've got to go from the ground up on this issue. And New Hampshire is not fully funded by any means. There's talk that it's several billion dollars underfunded. There's talk that it's $3 or $4 billion, $5 billion, and nobody knows. And nobody knows at the end site what happens to this town, to our balance sheet, and nobody knows what's going to go on with our employees. And it leads to this type of press where there's exclamations that future employees of the town of Hampton, that someone can say they'll be eating off of food stamps, and nobody can dispute that. And then others are saying that so-and-so is making so much in accordance with law and what he earned, and that's not right. And we don't have any actuarial accounting background. And we have no fixed costs. And we're not complying with government accounting standard. And we need to change that. Once the election's over, and anyone's free to comment on it at this late hour, but once the election's over, I will be making motions on those. And to incorporate that, I certainly think that the auditors this year need to listen to some of this, and I'm happy to sit down and discuss these exact same points with them or any member of the board, and I think that it's something that we need to pursue. I think it's consistent with our strategic responsibilities as leaders of the town. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
I have a couple of comments. One, in the interest of brevity, I'm not going to comment in any level of detail. I agree with Phil. We talked about it in some level of detail a year ago, and I think that to have an informed discussion on this subject, at least in the short term, Mike Schwalzer really needs to be here. So that's why I'm not. I've got some comments and all that kind of stuff, but it's not productive. I think the only question I have for you is if you would wish to defer that discussion until after the election. I think
that's fine.
I think that's wiser because you, you know, why come to a determination and then potentially have one or two or three different people on the board. It would just be a waste of time. But I think in order to have an informed discussion on that, Mike Schwalzer has to be here. And then there's nothing that prevents you from having a similar discussion in June or July when you've got another finance director on board.
Another reason that I put it out publicly is we can involve this in our discussion with prospective new hires.
Right. The only final comment I make, and the one detail that I will comment on, to GASB 45 and the requirement to report liabilities associated with other post-employment benefits, and as Phil said, that's health insurance. We do not provide, we as a town, do not provide any post-employment other post-employment benefits, health insurance. That is provided by NHRS. That is a liability of the retirement system, not a liability of the town of Hampton. So, Mary Louise,
yeah, just
something?
Really quickly, Mr. Pierce can probably confirm, how many years did I sit on that budget committee asking if we were complying with the latest GASB standards? I asked again and again and again. And number two, I don't want us to keep sitting here like sheep without the state paying its share of retirement. The state started this whole thing, and I think we should at least try to get some kind of action, because I'm very, very...
You mean back to the old teachers in Group 2? And
I'm very upset that the state has been allowed to pull out of what I consider to be an obligation.
I'd like to make one or two comments, Mr. Chairman.
Sure.
I think we should move up in the GASB world. I have no problem with that, but to count, sort of present a different point of view, depreciating buildings in a town environment is a fine thing, except what do you do with the depreciation? You use it for toilet paper, okay? Because the building either gets replaced when it's bad or it doesn't. Right. Depreciating it to zero, who cares? Nobody does. The government doesn't care. You don't get a tax write-off from the feds because we're not paying taxes. So that's academic. Okay, now when it comes to retirement money, and I think Phil is absolutely right, I'm not disputing his point of moving on to GASB. I'm just saying some of the points he brings up are, who cares? And the next one I'll bring up is, we have no control in this town about the retirement system. It's up to the state legislature.
Yes.
And if we build out, we say, well, our liability for the retirement today is $5 billion. Tomorrow, the state could say, oh, no, we've changed the system again, so it could be the double or half.
Yeah.
So, I mean, all of the things that GASB brings to this municipal accounting scheme is really the private sector.
Mm. Right.
They need these animals. Yeah. They need these items.
Well, let me finish, please.
Okay, let me finish. Yeah. I'm just saying that it's all good and dandy, except most of it in the grand scheme when it comes to Hampton is material you'll never use. It'll cost you a ton of money to put it in place.
Okay, I'd like to...
I just want to talk about one thing. One is there's the federal accounting standard boards, and that is for people like me in the private sector.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's the government accounting standard boards.
Yeah.
And depreciation is an expense, and if we have $10 million in assets that we're depreciating, and we're spending 30% down at the beach, then we need to allocate that and incorporate that into our charges for the state. So this is why this should be a question for selectmen, so we can have this debate, and we can educate you on how it's not.
I agree with your point about going to the state.
I agree with that.
Okay, we've got two guys who are sitting around waiting for a non-meeting. Let's move this off till after the election when the finance director is here. Next item under new business.
What happened? You got them all going.
Hampton PTA, SAU 90.
Also moved.
Has requested the use of selectmen's room on March 4th for the candidates' debate. That's been moved by Mary Louise, seconded by...
I second.
Mr. Pierce.
Seconded by Mike Pierce. All in favor? Aye. Great. Next one.
Also moved to expedite the Hampton Union's request.
Has requested the use of the selectmen's meeting room on February 28th for the selectmen's candidates' debate. Yeah. They've amended that to 6 p.m.
Correct.
Motion to approve has been made by Mary Louise.
I second it.
Seconded by Selectman Pierce. All in favor?
Ta-da.
Okay. I have one other item on new business.
Uh-oh.
And I just want to bring
it
up.
I thought you were moving along, Mr. Chairman.
Was everyone copied on the letter from Jones and Beach related to the request for the naming of the street?
Yes.
Okay. That's something...
Put it on for next week.
No, I will. But I just wanted to...
Aren't
they aware that my recollection
veterans
is that we made a decision 2 or 3 months ago to go further back in time to the French and Indian War. Is that the way everybody remembers it?
Back
I think it was your motion.
King Philip's War.
King Philip.
Yeah.
Thank you.
He wanted to make sure
was
to get
King
in.
King
Philip.
King Philip. I got it anyway.
Let's do that next.
Can I hold it? Let's wait. Wait a minute. Thank you.
Next week.
Do these streets represent going back to King Philip's War?
They do.
Okay. Great. Then we will put this on the agenda for the next meeting. Consent agenda.
I'll move the consent agenda number one, veterans credits and exemptions.
And I'll second that.
there happen to be 20 veterans credit.
Yeah,
are you differentiating from item 2 and 3, Mary Louise?
Well, for this, let's clean it. I mean, let's just do it. The veterans exemption is a veteran's exemption.
Let's move all three items on the consent agenda.
Oh, well, all right.
The second item,
happy.
Use of town property,
yep.
Request
Hampton
from the
Garden
Hampton
Club.
Garden Club, the annual plant and bake sale,
yep.
May 17, 2014. And the third item, Rockingham Planning Commission alternate appointments, Fred Rice and Ann Carnegie. Mary Louise has moved the consent agenda.
I will.
Mike Pierce seconded it. All in favor?
Wow.
Closing comments. Any closing comments?
Yeah, it's time to adjourn.
Yeah.
Is that a motion to adjourn?
At
yes.
10:13 p.m.
All in favor? Adjourn.
You said to give it together.